And hello, everybody.
Hey, folks.
Hello.
It's a hazy night tonight. Are you feeling all right?
No.
Fair. We're stoker.
How's everyone doing this evening?
This fine Christmas evening.
It's fine. Better than dead.
Not sure I can say the same.
So, we were at the bath.
This sure brings me back to my water selling days. Speaking of work, Aina, how are we doing over there? Boss, don't be like that. You know baths are good for you.
That is the most Aina we've seen so far.
Do we really gotta do this whole dance every time? Give me that sponge! Hey, come here! Ha! I gotcha! There's no escape now, you filthy rascal! Brush, 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 cleaning up the little boss!
It sounds like a toothbrush sound effect more than a bath brush.
Yes.
Maybe it is.
Yeah, maybe he's just using a toothbrush.
Maybe he is brushing.
Brush.wav.
But satisfied with his work, Adder locked Aina's head under his arm and dashed into the contiguous warm room. It wouldn't be completely out of place to say Adder dunked a quasi-sparkling Aina into the pool.
And you better not go crawling out till I tell you! You hear?
Aina raised her head over the water like a grim apparition. Hair on her eyes and murder all over her face.
So cute.
Her vengeance could not come to fruition, for it was misplaced by the sight of Sep's body, clad in nothing.
What? What did Aina see?
A towel.
What?
Sep was wearing a perfectly decent bathrobe under the towel.
No, she wasn't.
Everyone wore perfectly decent, family-friendly towels and bathing robes beneath them.
I'm 14, not stupid.
Her vengeance could not come to fruition, for it was misplaced by the sight of Sep's body clad in nothing but swimwear under a towel.
I swear to you that the first thing I'll do on my right day is come back and rewrite this.
You tell him, kid.
Be that as it may, Aina could have set some world records on the speed at which she paddled to hide her panic.
Oh, look. The shy little cabbage is finally showing her true colors.
So, you just need to imagine Sep not wearing a towel here, I guess.
Okay.
Way ahead of you.
Sep followed her leisurely, running a hand between the threads of long silver-white hair floating aimlessly in the water.
Wow. Your hair color looks even more unreal than the dye, doesn't it? Like fine spider silk in the moonlight, or the world's finest linen thread. To be honest, though, I only thought it looked like rice noodles when I was a child. Yum.
Sep glanced back at Adder. He was preoccupied brushing his antlers ferociously in the cold room. A rare moment removed from Adder's overprotectiveness for the both of them.
So you really don't remember me at all, do you? Who knows? Maybe you just need to take a closer look.
I volunteer.
Never one to miss a chance to make someone else falter, Sep casually wrapped an arm around the shorter girl's shoulders.
Then again, I don't look anything like the child you knew, do I? I used to have really stubby arms and legs, so much so that Illagrab started calling me Pumpkin. Actually, I don't know if he started it, but it caught on. I became Pumpkin first and Sep second.
Sep's hand sauntered toward the top of Aina's head.
Well, anyway, whenever you carried me, he'd say it was so sweet, we looked like a pumpkin pie. Can you imagine that? You were anything but sweet carrying me back there.
The taller girl's finger slowly traced the outline of Aina's increasingly red ears.
But you were always so patient with me when I was a child, remember? You even let me chew on your ears whenever I was scared. Could it be my fault they look like this now?
Aina shrugged her shoulders way past the line where any shoulder is supposed to elevate.
You don't know. We could always check.
That made it take a small bite out of the tip of Aina's right ear. In the last moment, she craned her face to rub her cheek against hers instead.
Honestly, I think I prefer it like this for once. You don't need to remember you ever knew me, Aina. I want you to see me as I am.
Yeah, that way the Westermark effect doesn't kick in.
Hey, what's going on over there?
Oh, you know, just girls being lesbians.
Yeah, super lesbians and animals.
All right. Set moved a smile away from Aina's face, leaving a flustered mess in her wake.
Nothing. Just watching a snowflake melt in the water.
Keep on calling her cute little nicknames. See how that turns out for you.
Every last remaining boiler went off on Aina's cheeks with the arrival of an extremely misproportioned stag coming in through the other end of the pool, leaving very little to the imagination. Oh, so Adder gets to be naked. Okay.
Yeah, of course.
But just to be clear, he was wearing a towel. It's just the steam.
Whatever, just let me write some steamy prose about my ancestors.
Yeah, that's a normal thing to say.
All right, everyone. Soak up nice and good, take a dip in the hotter pool, back to cool, and then it's right back out. The water feels great, but we ain't got time to waste splashing about all day.
No. I need a bath, Adder. A long, warm bath for my health. Besides, it's a well-known fact that people get their best ideas while they're bathing. Though, I'm sure you can't relate.
Hey now! You've been hip-deep in muck today! You don't get to make fun of me no more!
That's the thing about filth. Some of us actually rinse it off.
Aina laughed under her breath, making Sep smile and kind, which in turn made Aina skitter away again.
See?
Yeah,
even your
this
boss thinks he could use more baths. It's official now.
Yeah, right. She's one to talk, so to speak. Anyway, we should be running out right about now.
Adder couldn't keep his eye from flicking towards Sep's towel as she pulled her body close enough to bump shoulders.
You know, the
it's
towel that she was definitely
long
wearing.
Day, and you did a great job tricking the beasts. We can afford to relax at least 10 minutes, don't you think?
No, it ain't the beast what's nagging me right now. I got a bad feeling about this place. It's too fancy. This ain't what a house that's been abandoned for a year and some in Slander is supposed to look like.
And that's a bad thing, apparently.
Ignoring the very obvious one-eyed glare at her was sending her way, Sep kicked up her legs over his shoulders and sighed.
Lighten up a little, dear. I'm sure Aina will be more than capable of arranging something for us if it turns out we are taking a bath on private property. It means you'll get to hit people very hard today if they bother us.
Anna's best attempts to look reliable and menacing were cut short by the fact that she still wouldn't dare turn around to look at the ruminants behind her. So there they were, one gazelle stretching her legs, one deer anxiously glancing at the entrance, and one smith desperately trying to hide her face from the rest of the world. This quietude, of course, wouldn't last.
So, tell me, Adder, is forcing your boss to take a bath part of your job description, or is that more of a labor of love?
It's a mantle I took up when I got tired of seeing her covered in soot every day. Y'all like to talk trash about me, but that's because you ain't seen Aina thrashing around in it. Bagging fleas is easier than dolling up this little menace.
Adder patted Aina's spotless white hair.
Heligrab says her dyes used to last months before I showed up.
Adder and Aina frowned at each other. Then her tail started wagging.
Whose fault is it, huh? Who likes hopping in the mud every time it rains? Oh, yes, it's you. Such a bad boss. Yes, you are.
Adder started scratching Aina's cheeks and neck until her tail started wagging at full speed, splashing water all over the place.
Oh my gosh, she little puppy.
Smooch after smooch was peppered on Aina's little nose while she made some very half-hearted attempts at swatting Adder's face away.
This is legally adorable.
The duo only stopped upon noticing the blue eyes silently judging from afar.
Oh, no, please. Continue. I have no intention of getting into whatever that was.
Hey, don't make it sound weird. I'm just glad, because I haven't gotten to be with her like this in a while.
Like this?
Yes, that wearing towels.
Flicked her eyes down at their towels, then back up, turning both of their faces immediately red.
What?
To be honest, I'm a little disappointed. I was fully expecting you'd see her body and immediately say something like, "Bytatch beard, Bosh! Boobies!" Or, "Prex?" Do you prefer either word, Anna?
Anna shrugged until she slid her old body sans ears under the water, blowing bubbles for all response.
No way! I've seen chess before!
Mine doesn't count.
I wasn't counting yours.
I'm afraid not everyone can wear a cup like yours, Addison.
Anna catapulted herself out of the water, banging on the edge of the pool as she nearly cried her eyes out. Adder needed a second to understand.
No, hold up! I didn't mean it like that! I'm just saying I don't care about him. Not like I don't care for him. Y'all perfect from head to hoof. I just never really thought about... Look, I like what I like, okay?
And what could that possibly be?
Like you didn't know the answer to that question.
Oh, nuts. I'm not the one who's wondering.
What?
Step raised her eyebrows in Anna's direction, startling the little wide-eyed Smith back into the water.
Sip, come on! Quit messing with us already! We ain't got time to be fooling around today! We're gonna have to go streaking through the slums if we don't wrap this up and do some laundry!
I vote for that.
If you're so worried about our schedule, why don't you go and get a head start?
You know what? I will! Because y'all making me feel like I'm the only one with half a sense of responsibility left!
Good for you.
Adder 100% accidentally ducked Sep's head in the water as he stood up, so Sep completely, by chance, tugged on Adder's towel as he walked out in the pool, making him squeak. Once the storm of giggles had passed, Adder grabbed their pile of dirty clothes and a basin. He washed it filled with water, sitting down as physically far from Sep as he could all the while.
Sep, if I didn't know you any better, I'd say you're delaying us on purpose.
On the contrary, I'm maximizing our possibilities of survival. It's a very simple strategy, in fact. If we're going to hide, there's a possibility we'll be found. And if we're found, the most likely outcome is that we'll be brought to Elbar. He won't take me seriously when I encounter him if I look anything less than perfect.
Aren't you a little bit worried he may not care a whole lot about your looks after everything that happened today?
Of course not. I don't dress to impress the people who love me. I dress to impress the people who hate me. And I undress for the sake of the fashionably challenged.
Sticks and stones, Sep.
You should have really let me buy you new clothes when you had the chance.
Yeah, well, I would have fancier stains to wash off then.
Anna poked her face out of the water and pointed her left eye with a smile, making Adder groan in response.
Wait, what does that mean? Eye stain? A dirty patch?
Anna shook her head, laughing.
Adder, quick! I need more context!
It means I'm a dumbass who don't even know where his eye is anymore! Now if y'all done chewing the rag, I could really use a hand with this!
Adder channeled what remained of his patience into presenting Sep with a basin full of water and soap. Sep rolled her eyes with a secret understanding, bringing a hand into the bottom of the recipient. The water started to bubble into a near instantaneous rolling boil.
There. Be gentle with my skirt, dear. Silk is very delicate.
Yeah. Adder do everything as usual.
Adder turned around to go get their clothes, mumbling something about delicate silks under his breath.
Well, thank you kindly for manipulating temperature for me, darling. It ain't like I could do it myself or nothing.
Step sent a glance in the direction of her cooling down hand, opening and closing her still glowing fingers. Between the gaps, she spotted Aina's puzzled visage.
What? You didn't like my impression?
Anna tightened and loosened her hand into a fist, just like Sep had. On second thought, that was not an expression of confusion. Anna seemed absent, completely out of it. Her gaze was lost somewhere far beyond Sep's right ear, and her jaw was clenched with such strength that her mouth almost disappeared. A completely unreadable face, with intentions that remained a mystery. She finally focused back, startling Sep. In desperate bid to stop whatever it was that was managing to set her off so much, Sep reached out for the Smith's head, moved just by the vague impression that she'd seen Pertok do that before. It wasn't the whack of a cane this time, but a desperate caress. Just like it had come, it was gone, whatever it was. Anna remained completely unfazed, beyond the obvious surprise in her face from the unexpectedly kind touch.
You're all right. Everything is, well, you're here with us now, so it's about as good as it could be. Focus on that.
Anna looked around. She blinked slowly with big, dazed lilac eyes and then nodded, still looking a bit unsure.
I'm not great at this, am I? I'm sorry. If you're looking for a hug or something, you're going to have to ask.
It was only then that Sep realized that her hands were still burning white on Aina's skin.
Amazing. You really are immune to my fire, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
What in the name of living y'all talking about? Fire? Did I hear that right? What just happened here? What were you trying to do now?
Calm down. I wasn't trying to hurt her. I mean, I don't think I could to begin with. I was just trying to...
I don't give a darn what you were trying. You and I are going to have a chat on a little something called consent when we're done here, Missy. You all right,
safe,
boss?
Sane,
you
and
hurt
consensual.
Anywhere?
Anna was fine, save for a huge increase in bodily temperature that had very little to do with Sep's abilities.
She's fine, okay? Well, she's kind of not, but that's the whole point I'm trying to make. I couldn't hurt her on a physical level if I tried. She's invulnerable to my magic.
So what?
An alteration in your connection to the Hatsa, remember? That's how offensive Sephihet works. You can't just grab a rock and curse it. It doesn't have blood or any adequately prepared vessel to form a connection, right? The only living creatures that are not connected to the Hatsa and are therefore immune to alterations are plants. But does she look like a Makadar to you?
You ain't making a lick of sense, Sep.
Sep put her hands on her temples, trying to make her logic make sense.
When I found Aina back in the brig, she was completely lifeless. And I don't mean that figuratively, Adder. She was a literal rock until I fixed that. I'm not sure of what she is, but she's not alive in the same way you or I are.
You're starting to sound like Barabeth.
I hate to say this, but that's because he's right. Not about the golem part, of course. That's just nonsense. An object with an artificial bond would simply stop functioning if untethered, not disappear from everyone's memories. She must be a living being somehow.
She could have told you that. Sorry.
So here's the real kicker. She's not dead, and she is not alive. However, her whole sentience relies on the life essence provided to her, in the same way we rely on vegetal sustenance to keep us alive. If my deduction is correct, Aina's life force wouldn't be something organic or intrinsic, but rather applied to her and refillable. She's like a cursed mosquito, essentially. Before existing, she can recreate connections through the bloodstream.
What?
Oh, my.
Okay, that may be too difficult. Let's go back to the facts. I deduced that the only way to wake her up would be sharing a bond with her. But try as I may, I could not form a new connection that would let me tether some of my own energy to her.
Kay, look, I gave up trying to understand this whole thing like 2 minutes ago, but that sounds to me like maybe you should try to take it easy with all the bond and stuff.
It just means that someone was dead set on protecting her from anyone else's influence. So I had to find a way to provide my own life force to refill whatever powers her connection to the Hatsa and wake her up again without a bond.
Ada and Aina just stared emptily at Sep. She sighed.
She's not alive. She's not a golem. She functions like a golem, meaning she needs external power to exist. Someone powered her up. That someone didn't want anyone else doing the same. But her source of power was broken. She needed power again.
Sep turned her hand palm up and presented her forearm for them to see. A huge bite mark covered almost the entirety of it.
So I made her bite me.
Ooh. Adder recoiled in horror. Aina took her hands to her mouth.
Why would you do such a thing?
I was all out of options, and I figured the sharp teeth had to have a functional purpose, obviously. It's called science, Adder. Look it up.
Are you out of your god's damn mind? Why didn't you tell me? You could have...
Adder looked at Aina, unsure of what he was going to say. Of why he was going to say it.
Because I knew you would act like this. Don't you get it? I brought her back to life. I brought you into my own mind. I even managed to channel your thoughts without having to say a single word to persuade you.
Sep took her hands to Adder's chest and an ancient voice to his ears, eyes shining eerily in the reflections cast by the water.
And this is barely the beginning. Who knows what else I could achieve through these powers? What we could learn from creatures like her? If I could only find out how the beasts managed to deactivate her in the first place.
Yep, now you're starting to sound like a villain.
Yep.
Adder grabbed Sep's shoulders and gently pushed her away, refusing to meet her eyes.
You really do sound like Barabeth.
Adder grabbed the laundry basin and walked away from the warm room, reluctantly followed by Aina. Sep was left standing alone in the middle of the pool, dripping wet and frowning like a child who'd just been told no.
No, no evil.
No. You stop that now.
She wasn't just going to let the topic be, of course. She followed them into the locker room, her interest shifting pointedly toward Aina once more.
Aina's a good girl.
Though her first thought was heading straight towards her, she decided to make a very slow and deliberate beeline towards Adder instead.
Always the hero, Adderson of the higher field, protector of lost causes, defender of what needs not be defended.
Sep smiled, throwing both of her companions off. Then she turned to address Aina.
Funny that. He really seems to care a lot about you.
Adder didn't bother looking up from the fabric he was dousing in hard soap.
What's all the whispering for, Sep?
Sep didn't say a single word. She merely had to wait patiently in front of Adder's face for the boy to bring his own defeat. She always knew how to stand and how to speak to make his throat turn dry.
So how much does she know about our thing?
Sep, please. You know me. I'd never tell no one nothing at all.
I meant about the reminders that our own little bout with science left on your body. But we're all ears if you have something you want to share with the room.
Adder's jaw hung loose as he turned his head between Sep and Aina.
No? Then I take it she's well aware then of all the nights we spent dining together in my room? Of your promise to entertain me at the risk of indebting yourself to me for life? Of your oh-so-moving proposal?
Lo Dusnya asked, geez, why is she acting like a dick? Well, Sep really, really, really wants to be a princess, and she's basically a geisha. So she's trying to leverage basically everybody in order to prop herself up.
She's also, like, lived her entire life through manipulating others, and, like, that's
basically all that she knows, yeah.
It's pretty much second nature.
She knows how to interact with people.
She doesn't know how to turn it off.
Yeah. She wants something now. She sees something, and she wants it, and she does not ever stop in her goals. So, yeah, now even to her friends, she's going to be like this.
Aina took the bait, and Adder knew that Sep knew that he knew, too.
She didn't need to!
I see. So the noble-hearted Sir Adderson had the gall to swear his eternal love and allegiance to me while keeping my existence a secret from his sweetheart.
Say what? No, I wasn't keeping you a secret from her, specifically.
Ah, but you don't deny your feelings towards her. You just so casually forgot to mention that you spent all of Dawn Soon begging someone to untie your sash. I had a feeling that may be the case.
Adder's whole face turned so red it looked painful. Still, he spoke.
Say your piece, ma'am.
I didn't think you'd have it in you to cheat on anyone, Adder.
Anna's eyes grew bigger by the second, her emotions guarded under her scowl. She observed the scene regardless.
Ilgrab roped you into this or what? I wasn't cheating with you, or on you, or whatever it is you're trying to spin this into. I ain't courting Aina. I saw no reason to tell her who I was dining with.
Those horns you were having for dinner, you mean.
Now that's
oh,
not...
snap.
Where the hell is this coming from, Sip? I thought you said I didn't owe you any explanations.
And you don't. We established that much. But there's a third person in this room. Did she agree to any of this? Were you so scared she would let everyone know you're a horn eater somehow?
Aina's eyes were completely fixated on his now.
Well, no. Of course not. I just...
The tension of the situation was cut dramatically short by Sep's sudden laugh.
Aw, did that fluster you? You should know by now I don't care either way, Adder. My business is a discreet one. I just delight in seeing you writhe under the weight of your own self-righteousness sometimes.
She turned toward... to Aina with a grin that didn't end up quite mocking nor reassuring.
There you have it, Cabbage Head. He may be a liar and a coward, but for what it's worth, he loves you with all of his cheating heart.
I told you, it ain't like that. My conscience is clear as a sunny day, Missy. I ain't scared of what Aina thinks, because I know she don't give a friggin' bell pepper what it is I do with my life after work. Right, Aina? There ain't nothing between us.
A half-hearted nod Aina sent his direction made Sep's nonplussed... smile shift into a smirk.
If there's nothing between you at all, then it should be fine if I do this, right?
Zap leaned towards Adder and stole a long, hungry kiss that severed any connection the boy had to the world of the living.
Yes! Feed me!
I love her.
Thank you, Lynn.
I love her so much.
She's totally a shipper.
Anna's jaw fell to the ground. She could only move an index between Sep and Adder, failing to even form the thought required to attempt to sign anything.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did you want to do that after all?
Adder mumbled something that could have only made sense to the mind of a very touch-starved deer. Anna wielded this as the most pointed of arguments.
Ah, I see. So you did want to keep that kiss for yourself. It's okay. Here, you can have it.
This better be going where I think it's going.
Maxie! Maxie, oh. I swear to God!
Hell. Yes.
Of course.
Fuck the hell, yes.
Oh my God, I love you, man, but holy Jesus.
Adder's kiss was returned to Aina via Sep's lips.
Yes!
I am Lynn. I am Lynn 100%.
No, you're shaking right now, then. Like Lynn.
I am.
Lynn, will you please stop doing that?
No.
I need a highlights channel for this. I need a highlights YouTube channel for this Twitch channel, and it's just times where you guys say a thing and then it happens 30 seconds later.
Yep.
Because it happens all the time.
Often it happens less than 5 seconds later.
So we're all agreed this is the best chapter of this entire game, right?
All right, yes.
Everyone stared at the dust floating around in the steam, the temperature of the locker room several degrees higher than it was when they first walked in.
That's all the reaction I'm getting? How can you both be so useless? No wonder you're so convinced there's nothing between you. I prided myself in being a better teacher than this, Adder. Wouldn't you like to share with Aina a bit of what you've learned? Or shall we go over the lessons together one last time, as a reminder?
Oh, Adder remembered. Adder remembered plenty, and he was about to give her a piece of his mind when...
That sounded like the front door!
Hey, I smell a lot of soap. Someone's been fooling around here.
No, trespassers? But the lock wasn't busted or anything. It's gotta be one of the new peeps overdoing it again. Hello? Is someone around here? You can come out, it's okay. We won't stab on sight, I promise.
What are those thugs doing here? Didn't you say this place was cursed?
It was. I mean, it was supposed to be. I told you it looked too nice to be empty.
Aina, it's your time to shine. Do something.
Anna's eyes snapped towards Seth. The only thing that shone about her was her teeth.
I don't think it's them you ought to be worrying about.
Fine. Go keep those thugs entertained. I can handle this.
Yeah.
Inconsiderate as he could be sometimes, Adder would have never willingly abandoned Sep to learn from the consequences of her own actions. A sharp slap where the tail began spurred him on, however. The next naked stag waddled towards a previously locked entrance, praying to every god he could name. A huge, scarred white tail and a burly musketeer turned to glare at him. Adder recognized a duo from previous instances of assault and battery on his person. Nothing he hadn't survived already and wouldn't survive again. Adder gulped, and then leaned against the doorstep, trying to block the view of the locker while Sep escaped towards the farthest and hottest room.
Well, well, well! If it ain't Talkman Darbon shaking up the shack! Fancy seeing y'all here!
Oh, it was someone new after all! You startled us, you naughty beanpole! What are you doing sneaking around here so early? The sun's still up!
Oh, nothing much. Usual mom stuff, if you can believe it. This buck came here to wash up with some friends after we got real low and dirty today. Yep, it's me and my super buff friends here.
Oh, so, boy.
You know, please don't kill me.
We know how this is gonna go.
Adder shrugged vaguely towards the steam-filled hot room.
Oh, sounds fun. Hello.
A horrible growl and a big splash echoed all over the building.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they're kind of busy right now. Doing, stuff.
Tis, tis, tis. This is why I hate the discreet guys. Talk about eager. I know this is slander, but sheesh.
manners, Beesh. You ever heard of them? At least you had the decency to say hi. You new around the area?
No, I've been surviving uphill for a year and bit. I'm pretty much local by now.
You pulling on my leg? No. You ski off flat for reals? Shave my horns for tinder. I ain't tried to mug you since you was this big.
That's right. The fat roe was here. Oh, talk about going to waste. Oh, for shame.
Has Adder eaten anything since chapter 3?
I don't know if he has.
Just wondering how long he can go without any food whatsoever.
For shame.
He's going through the dessert stored in his hands.
The ruffians nodded to themselves mournfully.
Why, thank you kindly. I think I look better too, but Stag's gonna love himself where he can, and where's the slander right now?
If I'd known you was gonna turn out like this, I would have cut you some slack.
I keep telling you, you can't rob every cute buck dry. You gotta leave them with enough to survive if you ever want a chance to find someone to settle with.
If they can't even wrestle enough out of my hands, I wants nothing to do with them.
Oh, that's right. These are two of the characters I read for.
Adder wasn't the most perceptive of bucks, but every so often, even he could put one and one together when someone was screaming two in his face.
Oh, so you two were... And this is the sort of place where y'all... Oh, what the hey? I've eaten my fair share of horns already. Y'all got some lovely racks there.
Oh, thank you, sweetie. That's very kind of you. We're gonna have to work on your compliments, though.
Ha! Easy off sled, all right. So... How come we ain't seen none of this lankiness here? Mr. Asshat didn't tell you about this place?
No. He did. But he mentioned a curse and...
Ah, yeah. The curse.
Brookie says, oh my god, Tuckme is wearing a harness. Yeah, no, they literally just said this is a hookup, like, bathhouse.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The curse is literally to keep everybody else away, apparently. That's what it's going to tell them.
That Beesh only visits on fifth days. He'll have your horns before you even had a chance to say hi, if that's your thing.
Ask Geoff's lad, will you? For shame.
For shame.
The muggers laughed loudly, shaking their heads and patting Adder's back, half mockingly, half reassuringly. They only stopped their inside jokes when they realized Adder had no idea what they were talking about.
I mean, you know why Geoff is so well known around slander, right? Why he chose to live here?
Because he's incredibly gay, yes.
Because he can't afford to be anywhere else?
Nay, the lad loves it here. He got the smell of money to him. But says he never felt he belonged more than when he ran away to the slums.
That crazy stumpy mushroom just sprouted up at Slander one day with his hat and his dramas and his bad music. You know, Geoff. He lived his life so carefreely that a lot of us felt kind of inspired to find that strength in ourselves, or something like that.
You saying Mr. Bard started this?
No, of course not. Geoff wouldn't put an ounce of effort into making things easier for anyone if it cost him his life. But I guess he did kind of plant that seed inside of us.
Him always the one.
Well, there we go. There we go.
Wow.
There we go.
Just went for it.
Wow.
Went for it.
This game is filled with so much innuendo. Just like...
I was trying to be good.
Chock-full.
Is it even innuendo
up to
point?
The brim.
I want the record to show I was trying to be good.
I was sitting here and the whole time we were watching Aina on screen. I'm like, oh god, please don't have any nips. I don't care if she's trans. It's female presenting. It's not okay on Twitch.
Female presenting nipples.
Adder pressed his lips into an awkward line while the older guys chuckled.
It's how it is, yeah? Lots of bad things happening in Slander, but we got enough to deal with go telling people how to lead their lives. That's why we don't let the guards anywhere around here. We figure to be a perfect place for a lot of folk. We may be crud, the bunch of us, but we keeps an eye out for those that got nowhere to feel home. And we'll peel the skins off anyone that dare lay a finger on them.
Well, some of us still adore having this little bit of privacy, though.
And big hunks of bulky meat. Loads of those in rough places.
Hookmay pinched Darbon's sagging underarm, chuckling to himself.
I never realized this place had so much life, I guess. Something y'all want to protect, even here. It's kind of moving, for real.
Oh, this beanpole! You're secretly a poet, aren't you? Just ditch Mr. Big Hat already. You're gonna become a star someday, sweetie. Or at the very least, a niche market speciality.
You are going to become, if not the greatest accordion player, then the most well-known within a very specific niche genre of music.
Mm. Find a whole lot of stuff to eat. You'll become the cream of the crops of slander.
The couple laughed again. This time Adder joined too.
Hey, speaking of eating, I'm afraid one of my friends is going to get a good bite if I don't run back soon. But, it's been great getting to meet y'all. I'll come hang out some other time, if that's all right.
But of course, dear. Take as much time as you need. Just make sure to clean up after yourselves when you're done.
Don't be a stranger, lad. Say hi the next time we beat you.
Nah, sure will. Wait, what?
The two thugs stayed in the locker room, getting ready for the evening ahead. Adder needed to get mentally ready for his own, too. He traced his friend's steps, signs of struggle, rather, hurrying towards a room where he'd abandoned Sep and Aina to their luck. An impenetrable wall of steam made it impossible to see anything inside. Though Adder was briefly tempted to grab his clothes and run far, far away, where he wouldn't have to deal with the fallout and the grief of whatever had become of Sep, his sense of responsibility wouldn't let him budge. And so, he walked into the room, a sense of extreme dread filling his chest.
They're gonna be wrapped around each other, aren't they?
Dead?
The only person who looked half-dead was Aina, floating belly up in the hot pool right next to a sitting Sep, thoroughly soaked and covered in shallow cuts and soon-to-be bruises. Sep barely glanced back as she waved.
What happened here?
Oh, Adder, I don't think you're old enough to hear about it. It seems your horn-eater meetup went well, at least.
Don't think I can't tell what you're trying to do, and let me tell you, it ain't working.
I'm not trying anything. On the contrary, I've always found curiosity a very attractive trait.
Well, I'm real curious about getting the hay out of here right after you tell me how you managed to pull this off.
I'm not going to get a rise out of you this time, I see. Please, allow me to demonstrate. Aina, sit.
Aina opened her eyes, stood up, and sat on the steps of the pool without delay.
Now,
Oh, this just keeps
getting kinkier. Do a handstand and somersault.
Aina obliged, and it was amazing.
All right, already. I got the idea. Quit doing the magic voice thing.
No. You haven't seen the important part. Aina, good job. Who's a good girl? Oh, are you going to act all coy now that your boyfriend is here? Who's a good girl? You are. Yes, such a good girl.
Aina started shaking and drumming her legs so fast that the floor threatened to break.
Hey, that's our thing. You stole it from me, you cheater!
Sep raised her eyebrows condescendingly, but added nothing else. A quick worried glance back at Aina revealed that she seemed completely unconcerned about both this extremely uncharacteristic display and literally anything else in the world.
You sure you're okay with this?
Aina cocked her head at the question. Okay with what? She seemed to ask, as if this was the most natural and evident thing she had ever done in her life.
I don't know what happened. She went from trying to drown me to being at my beck and call. Not even a smidge of attitude about it until you came back.
Yeah, she could be a little bit like that. Foaming at the mouth, raging one moment, and the next she's asking you for sugar. I got this nagging feeling in the back of my hunch there's got to be some itty-bitty tiny detail you're keeping from me all the same.
You can just see for yourself if you don't believe me.
Adder sat down next to Sep, observing as she pulled Aina towards her. She started scratching her jowls to demonstrate the smith's, mansuetude. I do not know that word.
That is a fancy word.
Narcy has this crazy vocabulary. That means gentleness, apparently.
Mansuetude.
How do you pronounce it?
I think that's how you
it. It is mansuetude.
Mansuetude.
It ain't like I don't want to believe you, ma'am, but I reckon you'll forgive me if I'm a little suspicious after that whole science tirade.
Who knows? Maybe I really fried her mind when I let her eat me.
Excuse me?
Bite! You made her bite you! Oh,
Why are you like this, Sip?
Because it bothers you. Why else?
Sip lifted her arms up, releasing Anna from her bliss, only to shift her attention to Adder.
Won't you let me bother you both?
Lynn, you are my self-insert.
Also, I like Adder's face in the background while she does that.
Yeah.
Hold on a second, I need to take a picture of this.
Yeah, it's very important.
Yeah, Adder's blep face and then Ida also kind of blepping.
It's a perfect moment right here.
Where she's got like a woo face, kind of.
I am so glad that Lynn is a part of this game to provide the reactions that we're all feeling.
Bother us! Gee, Sam Black, you ain't done enough of that today!
Adder's eyes shifted towards Aina. Sep immediately grabbed him by the cheeks and turned his head back to her.
Are you really going to ignore me twice and then crawl back when we're alone? Keep playing dumb until the end of the world so no one gets hurt? Wouldn't you rather be honest with yourself for once and seize everything you want? You don't have to choose every time, Adder.
All right, that's it, time out! This ain't no time to be talking or kissing or any other ends you got in your head right now, ma'am!
So when will it be? I'm afraid that between getting eaten by a pack of beasts and murdered by the fiancé you stole me from, my schedule may be a little tighter than usual in the foreseeable future. You want to spend our time wisely? Then get over whatever deep denial complex you two have, and let's just
focus on the situation at hand! Right, boss?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Come on, Adder. Come on.
It ain't like we got them self-denials or any of that radish stew you're trying to feed us. We're, Smiths. Yeah. Iron-hearted folk. We're the best at staying focused. You won't distract us from our mission.
I'm not trying to... Fine. You're hopeless. I give up. Just humor me for a second, and I'll leave you alone. Hold her hand for me. That's all I ask. If you two die without ever having held hands, I'm going to be really mad at myself.
Adder and Aina looked at each other. Then they looked at Sep.
Just holding hands? And you promise you'll lay this whole thing down?
I promise. You do still remember how I feel about promises, right?
Adder couldn't even keep his gaze on his boss as he wrapped one of his massive hands around her hand and wrist and forearm. Aina held onto one of his fingers in exchange.
Your form is unorthodox, to say the least. But it will do. Now, what are we thinking?
Do we have to do this?
Indulge me.
I'm thinking one of these shovels would be enough to scoop her up.
Gods, I know. And how does that make you feel?
Good. Embarrassed. It makes me feel like I can... Like I want to protect her.
Great breakthrough. But is that something you want, Aina? Do you want Adder to protect you and hold you and tell you what a nice little boss you are?
Anna glanced away like she hadn't heard.
I asked you a question. Is that what you want?
Quit it, Sip. You know she can't give you an answer.
It's a yes or no question. She can move her lips or bend that tree stump she has for her neck, I presume.
Well, she don't gotta answer you.
I suppose that's true. Nobody has to do anything if you boil it down to a matter of personal obligation. But you can't just trudge through life expecting others to understand your every need without letting them know how you feel. That's not fair.
Oh, and you're an expert on fairness now.
You're the one who taught me that, you clodpole. Why are you being so difficult about this? I'm giving her the chance to tell you she wants you herself.
She can't tell me!
But you can know!
She can't let me know what she don't think to begin with! Leave her alone!
Sep surrounded Adder's neck with her arms, apparently leaning in for a hug. Then she let herself fall backwards into the pool, dragging the boy's head underwater with her. Adder struggled for a moment, flailing and trying to pull away, but when he finally opened his eye, he saw her. Those intense blue eyes staring back at him, dying to be heard.
I don't care if she's a beast, a doe, or a dehorned gazelle, Adder. Eka talks about Aina like she was her sun, her stars, and Baitatse itself. Trust me, I know. Mom used to talk about me that way. I have no idea how long one of their cycles is supposed to be, but seeing how feeble Aina's connection to the world is, there should be no way any of them could remember her past a couple of days. Not unless they were being actively reminded. I'm trying to get close and wear her down for a reason. I know it's cruel, but I beg you, stop getting in the way of my plan.
Adder had to hold back the physical need to sigh underwater, turned instead into a stream of bubbles leaking out of his snout. He focused on thinking with his mouth closed.
Look, Sam, you're real smart and I'm not. You'd know something's wrong way before I do. I got no clue of curses and cycles and whatnot either. But I've never had a problem remembering Aina. Not a single day since I've known her.
That's the thing. You see her every day. You don't have to remember anything. Even just hearing her name would be enough to jog your memory most of the time. We've been through this. You wouldn't even know if you had forgotten. This is not the time to lull on loyalties anymore. I need your help to learn if she's truly devoted to you, or if she's just been fattening you up so her sister could bite off your...
Adder pulled a whole hand over Seb's face and lifted her out of the water, effectively shutting her up. He only followed her out tentatively once it was clear that she got the message.
Fine. Have it your way. Show me I taught you better than we both thought.
He'd be the one dealing with his friend. No magic or conspiratorial whispers required. Adder took a long look at Aina, who was just looking at them from the steps, clearly unbothered by the apparent murder attempt. He heaved a real sigh this time.
Boss, you know I love you, right?
Anna's blush shone bright underneath her, white fur. She nodded quickly with her head low.
I'm told I'm real darn fond of secrets for how much I talk. Thing is, I've been thinking a lot about what love is these last few moons. No, that ain't quite right. I've been thinking about what it means to love someone. What it means to me, anyway. I always thought loving meant caring. Wanting someone special to be well all the time. To be that perfect little shine in your eyes. Because I thought loving meant seeing only the good parts of the one you love. Defending them, even from your own thoughts. Sep here made me realize that when you live pretending someone's perfect and everything's fine in the world because you're together, you're not looking at what's in front of you. You're loving a whole other person you made up in your own head.
Adder took a deep breath. Sep sent a concerned look in his direction, but he shrugged it off.
I'm sorry, boss. I've really tried my best to let it be. To make like I couldn't notice when things were out of place. But this whole thing is a lot. It's way too much. It's way, way, way past that. We're all in danger. Or at least, me and Sep are.
Aiden's throat moved with a gulp. The corner of the room stood narrow and suffocating in contrast to how big Adder seemed looming over her.
I love you. And I know somewhere down there, you love me too. That's why I think it's time you came clear about some things.
I mean, is she?
I don't know. Don't think she is.
Probably the second would be.
Yeah, I would say the second one is probably better to be less accusatory.
You're not a doe, and I know that. What are you then?
Anna's mouth moved senselessly.
You won't get anywhere asking questions like that. Remember, mind the envelope more than the letter.
This really ain't the time for riddles, Sip.
Didn't you want to be in charge? Then figure it out, Adderson. I'm not going to sit by and watch you do a shoddy interrogation job.
Gazri.
You do need to ask it directly.
Are you a beast?
You need to ask yes or no questions. Because, you know, she's mute. Anna furrowed her eyebrows confused. She shook her head slowly and surely.
You don't know either?
She's not quite telling the truth, but it doesn't seem like she's lying.
You think the patron could take such a big chunk of memories out of someone that they forget what they are?
I couldn't even start to guess. She may have never known to begin with.
Steph sounded a little more affected than usual as she trailed off.
I like how you can just ask the silly questions here.
So, I'm gathering you really knew the beasts then. Yeah, 'cause you're sister after all, huh?
Anna shrugged her shoulders until her neck disappeared. Then she nodded.
So, you're a beast too, then?
Not necessarily.
Say what? Why are you replying for her now?
Because you're making stupid assumptions about how families work. Just stick to the facts.
So wait, is the patron your paw for real, or...
Anna nodded, confused. She didn't seem to understand what Adder was getting at.
What in the name of the Hatsa is for real supposed to mean here?
I don't know, maybe she's adopted, or...
And what's that to you?
Right. Sorry. When we were alone, Ica said you'd asked to get me on board. You wanted me to be part of the crew. So that means you... You knew they'd be coming, didn't you? What they'd be coming for?
Anna shut her eyes with a fear Adder had never seen in her. She nodded.
You really did know about this whole thing.
I think it's fair for Adder to be mad about this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? No. Come on now. You're kidding me. You knew they wanted to hurt people. Eat people. And you just let that be? Why didn't you... How could you just stand by? I thought you got a heart somewhere in there, no matter what y'all said. I thought you cared deep down. But this? Come on. I thought we were friends. I thought we were...
Adder stopped himself mid-sentence. There it was. The same look as the one she'd seen in his eye when Ica held her tight in the ship. Anna's lips moved, but they spelled nothing. Hard as he tried to dig in the dry well of his heart, Adder couldn't finish the thought. Anna shoved him back the second his mouth opened again, effectively launching him across the room. Everyone in the room seemed equally confused about what happened. Both the apprentice lying on the ground against the wall and the smith that pushed him, and even the girl watching from afar. But there was no backtracking now, not with Anna taking the lead. Dashing faster than time itself, Anna leapt over the stunned boy and kicked his head down, propelling herself toward the narrow windows on the ceiling. Adder needed a longer than usual moment to fully grasp what just happened, but the sight of a fluffy white tail disappearing past a hole somewhere above him finally returned him to reality.
Anna, will you quit running away already? Get back here! I'm not done! Ada! Please come back. I just wanted to do things right.
Step finally scuttered away from the column behind which she'd taken cover. She glanced silently at the deer on the ground, then back at the window, measuring her words.
You did as well as you possibly could have. There was no way to avoid holding this conversation in the end.
Gazelle let her back slide down against the wall next to Adder.
I wish you would have let me read her mind to get a straight answer, but there's no use crying over it now.
I thought she would trust me enough to...
Trust is a two-way door, Adder. You wouldn't have trusted her with your secrets either.
Quit with the gaze reader act for once, will you? You don't know that. You don't know crap about me.
The look Sepp sent his way spoke volumes. Adder sagged until his antlers touched his knees. He put both hands on his face and sobbed into them.
Am I a bad friend?
Sepp wouldn't answer for the longest time. She simply shuffled her body forward with all the grace the situation allowed and carefully let her head rest against his shoulder.
You're bad enough for me.
Once more, Sepp surrounded the base of Adder's neck with her arms, slowly, carefully. The boy looked down, finding her face so very close as her hands reached his head. His lips found hers through admiration, and desperation refused to let them go.
We can't. We gotta find her.
You know where she's going. Let her make things right. She can take care of herself.
You sure?
No. But I need you right now.
This simple confession, a moment of lost vulnerability, was enough to make Adder's heart and senses melt into pure foolishness. Their kisses made them stumble from wall to wall until they found themselves slipping back into the pool, thinking, but not alone.
Ooh, sorry. I didn't expect anyone here yet.
Finally.
Everything started without me, huh? Well, too bad. Uncle Gyoff needs to tell someone about his day.
Gyoff! Oh, Lord.
Adder! What brings you here? Who told you about this place? What did they tell you?
I should be the one asking that. What are you doing here, Bard? I thought you said this place was cursed.
Yes, it's incredibly cursed. You should never come here again. And less so today of all days. I've been looking for you everywhere.
You thought I'd be in a bathhouse?
No, you thick skull! I got tired and assumed you'd be off somewhere frolicking with that beloved golem of yours! Right after I saved your butt, too. Ugh! Who let you in? Was that her just now?
Say, what? I wish. It's just you and me, Bard.
Adder? What's wrong? You didn't scream she's not a golem.
Nothing's wrong. It's just us friends here.
Yeah, off watching intently as a pair of horns and a fluffy tail attempted to dive away from the scene.
I don't even know why I tried.
Bard, it ain't what you...
Save it! I don't want to hear it! I don't want to know a thing about you two! No, you have to tell me all of it! Don't you dare say a word before we get home! And for the love of Vitat, put something on!
I thought they were wearing tails.
Adder took a long look at the situation. His rundown shack, Geoff, Sep, himself. A quiet breath that precedes a plunge into the depths of the unknown. He raised both of his hands slowly, as if trying to stop time itself.
Alrighty. Let's go over this one more time. No insults, no buts, no she said, I said. So you see, Mr. Bard, we're...
A pox! A pox on your house for stealing this poor lad's innocence! I should have let them burn you, you light-fingered tramp!
A fine insult for yourself, but what am I?
A dunce is what you are! Both of you! I should have known his tears were the product of your evil arts from the very beginning, insidious corruptress! Backstabber! Strumpet! You knew my friends were off limits!
Oh, you have any of those left?
Sure he does! He's got me, and I can promise you that Sip got no clue we knew each other at all. See, turns out I met her like a year ago, and I kinda helped her, and then we met again in the slums, and she offered to tell my fortune, and...
Fortune teller, yes, and I'm a gardener! In my many years working with tools, I've learned to call a spade, and a hoe a hoe.
Oh, snap.
Wow. I knew it was coming.
And yet you still have the gall to call yourself both a bard and my brother.
Easy now, you two. That's not how bros should talk to each other.
Good thing we're not siblings, then.
Oh, how I wish if that were true! Then I wouldn't have to bear the need of removing my eyes for having witnessed such a scene! Ugh!
Always the drama queen.
You, of all people, should not be talking about queens, honey!
Then you should not be lecturing me on who I lay with. Or are you just jealous I got to him first?
Oh, it's on, you little...
Can you two shut your snouts for 1 second?
All their neighbors echoed the thought with far less gracious words. Adder pulled his hands back little by little, shifting his remaining eye between the two.
Geoff, we got something real important to tell you. So how about we all take a nice, deep breath and calm down for us?
Calm down? You should have thought of that before taking my sister to bed!
I wouldn't have even looked in her direction if I'd known that! I mean, to be fair, it hasn't happened once since I found out, so...
Which was right now, so...
This... was a recurring thing? No, don't tell me! I don't want to know!
Please. You shouldn't even need to ask.
If I'm asking, it's precisely because I know you, Omaseptuk. I know that little rotten, cynical mind of yours like it was my own. What were you hoping to achieve by tangling this poor little fool in your wiles?
I wasn't trying anything. I'm only here because I wanted to help.
Help? Help who? Help me become an uncle? Help Adder fight his profound loneliness? What kind of help could you give anyone? Haven't you broken enough families yet?
Stuff a sock in it, Geoff. You ain't got the foggiest idea what Seth's been going through.
Oh, and oh, you think she's God. Bared her soul to you just because she's bared her ass?
Adder made to lift a fist in reply, only to be stopped by the gentle push of Sep's hand on his chest.
I burned him. On purpose.
Geoff's nostril flared open as his eyelid slid down.
You even gave him your name.
Though Adder was thankful for the sudden peace the gazelle had built upon just 5 words, he lacked any context whatsoever to understand the situation.
You think we should tell him now?
Geoff's eyes sprung open again.
Tell me what! And you say you've seen all of this happen, and it wasn't just a figment of Adder's imagination.
They were real, Geoff.
And they were hungry.
Geoff needed a moment to assess the situation.
All right, that's as good of an excuse as any to finally turn a page in the story of our lives. Pack the bowls and the lamp. I have to gather a few provisions for the way. We'll be out of town before nightfall.
Whoa, hold on, Bard. You're running like a scalded hand here. You sure you want to get like that? On just our word? I know you worked real hard for this place.
Adder, my lad, what kind of self-respecting bard would leave his best friend alone in his darkest hour? No, what kind of herald would do such a thing? I swore that I would make you a knight, and a knight I'll make you, be it here or at the end of the world.
So what's the actual reason?
Can't you see, you hoofhead? The city is brimming with beasts, and you're eloping with a knight's fiancé! Of course we're leaving! So, how does Daldybrew sound? Too swampy? Oishent! How about we go touring the western limits instead? I'm sure the Cheetiles would be happy to have more heirloomite musicians to boo.
But it ain't like you're just fixing to sneak out, right? I mean, someone's gotta warn the rest of the city. Tell everyone what's coming to them. There's a whole darn lot of people in danger out there. I ain't even said bye to Aina.
Like ships in the night, Adder dearest. We live in wonderful times where we can just ask the Farfagin a few towns over to send sound blooms to all the friends we're leaving behind.
And what will I tell them then? Hey, y'all, I'm so sorry I left y'all here to get digested. We can't abandon everyone to their luck.
Sep, tell your boy toy that we have to leave right now.
Oh, yes, of course. Run! You two are so fantastic at it, you may even last a day before you get eaten.
I'm sorry, I think I just heard something stupid!
Why would you run when we don't even know how many beasts are coming? We still have assets we can use in our favor! Our situation hangs on just a long string of misunderstandings. We could solve them and protect the city at the same time!
Wouldst thou have me go on another pointless quest to clear someone's name to save the kingdom? Unlike Dad, Adder has actually done something. They have reasons to want him dead. Or are you perhaps suggesting that he follow your life choices, We could change his name to High King and wait for everyone to forget there was ever an Addersyn. Is that what you want, Sep? Should I go fetch Rochelle and ask her to be his procurer too?
Why bother with a middleman when you know all about pandering?
Assface!
Nimrod!
Enough!
The silent summon into the room was as tense as it was fragile. It only lasted until Adder breathed again.
This is all your fault, isn't it? You filled her mind with all those stupid made-up stories about honor becoming a knight. Like this pea brain needed any more fuel for her delusions.
Adder looked away, futilely trying to hide a scowl from himself.
Let's just find a way to get you home safe, Sep. Golf's ain't no place for a sane person.
Yes, go back to your gilded cage. Drink your fat ass to sleep and let the adults handle the rest.
I can't go anywhere. I've been kidnapped.
Sep let her head fall in Adder's lap. Adder's hands flew away as far from her as physically possible.
I've surely been tied up and locked, my fate resting completely in Captain Adder's wandering hands. Oh, how the tables turn. It was usually the other way around, wasn't it?
She was the one who... It's all lies!
Trying to embarrass me with such pitifully immature tales? That's hardly a story. If you heard the things he mumbles to himself at night when he thinks I'm sleeping, you wouldn't be able to look him in the eye again.
What are you talking about?
They can hardly be worse than the things he said in my bed.
Go back to arguing, please!
Well, it sure looks like a hostage situation in here. There's nowhere to run when it comes to Thar's kids, Adder.
Everyone turned their heads up to stare at the tree man in complete disbelief.
Sorry for coming through the roof, Guff. There's some edible mold on the beams. I thought you may like to know.
Don't you dare act all friendly with me, you heartless stump! How did you find this place?
I have to admit that Talid was understandably uncooperative about this particular case, so I had to enlist the help of a few friends to find your little abode. I've known for a while now, really. I just figured you wouldn't be very happy if I dropped by without a reason, and I'm sure your little sister couldn't agree more with that sentiment. Odd place to hang out after a trial, but I'm not one to judge.
Oh, Illagrab. Belagrab laughed heartily at his own pun, but he was quickly quieted down when he saw it didn't land so much as crash into the ground burning.
You come to arrest us?
Arrest you, Adder? For what? Stealing a lady's heart and getting away with it? Please. Elbar's just abusing his power as usual. That's just your case, of course. Slapping a noble deer unconscious in the middle of the plaza is a little bit higher on the crime list. But I figure we both know by now that Miss Jasif never lived under the same metaphysical rules as the rest of us do. She can do as she pleases. I'd have to get a bit more serious about this whole ordeal if Elbar were to stop screaming he's been betrayed and start treating it as an abduction, of course. But I'm sure you'd be quite a few leagues away from Heirloom by then.
Are you encouraging us to escape?
Me? I would never, Pumpkin. That could get me in trouble, you know. I'm just saying that if I were anyone but me, I definitely wouldn't stick around to watch what happens when Sir Ascadath gets his title upgraded to Lord.
Stop listening to him! Don't believe a single word this murderous creep says! He was spying on us!
Do you have to drag your grievances into everything, Goth? I was waiting for the right moment to say something. The conversation wasn't exactly letting up.
How much did you hear then?
More than I care to know. But, you know what they say. Safe, sane, and something, something other.
You just talk like Stoker right then.
Yep.
No clue where you're going with that, but we ain't got time for a lesson. If you ain't here to take us prisoner, there's something you gotta hear before you get.
Hold your buckthorns, lad. I said I wouldn't show up without a reason, and I meant it. It's a mission of the utmost importance and urgency, in fact. Have any of you seen Aina?
You're out here looking for her?
That I am. I've walked half the city already. As messed up as it is, she's still basically a child in the eyes of the law, Adder. And her father's, if he had any. He desperately wants his daughter back safe and sound, and we're kind of short on hands at the moment. First, it's Elbar screaming, "Send all the guards to find him! Don't come back until you bring me his head!" And then you have Red yelling, my daughter, bring her back to me this instant, you wilted willow!" And who's paying for Illagrab's overtime, huh? No one. Speaking of which, it took me ages to get Red off that darned pyre without you, lad. Don't worry, I did manage to find a new helping hand just in time, but if I were you, I'd keep an eye out for any sudden bounce of hair loss. You may have a new curse or two on your shoulders.
Illagrab trembled slightly at the thought of more flames.
Oh, well then, I wish I could stay here chatting all evening, but I really should get going before someone in the neighborhood tries to chop down this noise disturbance. Send Aina my way if she drops by. I feel like she's due for a little reminder on the meaning of the words home invasion.
But wait, Illagrab, you can't leave for—
I know, you want to clear your name. That is extremely brave of you, kiddo, but it is not a wise choice right now.
That ain't—
Fine. I'll tell you what, if you really, really feel like going through with this, I'll be waiting for you all day in the keep tomorrow. You can just drop by, explain your position, and I'll make sure to listen close.
The city's full of beasts!
Illagrab blinked. Then he started cackling.
Of course, the city is brimming with beasts. That's why you had to run away. Classic Adder. You can tell me all about these beasts if you decide to show up tomorrow. Have fun with your sleepover, kiddos. Don't forget to check for beasts under your bed.
Graf's chuckles could be heard well after he left Slander District. When only the faintest traces of fresh pine fragrance remained in the air, Geoff looked left and right, hoping to find some newly sprouted hesitation. The only thing that grew in Aina's absence was the determination in her apprentice's visage.
You're not actually considering his offer, are you?
You got wax in your ears or what? This could be our only chance to get a word in with him.
Get a hold of yourself, you melon head! That was nothing but a poorly laid trap! Not to mention, not a problem to either of us once we're 300 leagues away from Erlem!
Adder's lip remained firmly shut.
Come on, we have to leave! We'll disguise ourselves as a traveling troop! Adder, you can learn how to juggle rocks along the way! Me, I need to find a new hat and a northern accent! Sep, you just continue to be a hindrance, it'll be fine! We'll be—
I'm not going anywhere, Bard.
What?
I don't want to run anymore! I'm tired, all right? I don't want to have to run again. I don't want to leave my family behind every time. I've got nowhere to go but here.
Adder, come on. Lad, my lad, we are friends, you and I. I gave you a place to live, and I taught you how to survive. Don't throw everything away for a girl, a rock, a tree, and a senile old geezer. I know. We'll find you a nice doe in the steps. I'll seal her boyfriend, and you get to console her, and then you'll settle down together in the farm of your dreams and have all the funds you want.
Don't bother, Gyoth. It's like talking to a brick wall.
Darn right it is. I made up my mind that I ain't fixing to die any day soon. So don't you worry about a thing, Bard. All this thick skull needs is a little more time to come up with a master plan and a touch of magic to make his words as pretty as they can be.
Patterson a week in Sep's direction. He got an eye roll for his effort.
Fine! Do whatever you want! It's not me they're looking for!
Gyoth slammed the door shut, taking all the air in the room with him. Sep and Adder shared a glance under the last few sunrays.
Never mind! I'm not leaving you two alone in my house!
Gyoth kicked the door open. He'd seemingly produced out of the air two plates of bread, boiled beans, and sweet lichen that Adder had never even smelled before.
You get one night, and that's it! One night to let you clear your mind, get some rest, realize how stupid what you're saying is, let reality sink in, and then we leave. Understood?
He tossed a plate at Sep's face before curling down on his side of the room.
Good night, Sop. Make sure to smash any flea you see.
Sep gawked at the unsophisticated meal and then back at Adder.
Please tell me he's not serious.
Okay.
Sep just egged herself to sleep. Time slogged by that night. Soft snores and crickets in the distance. Shrubs had been bitten down to the branches jittered around, trying to find a place to sleep. Adder searched the depths of his own mind for wisdom he lacked, trying to find a solution. To nothing in particular, to everything that was happening, to each and every last mistake in his life that brought him to this moment. But no answers ever came. All he could do was struggle even in his dreams.
You can't stay here. You have to leave.
I can't.
Adder.
Adder nearly had a cardiac arrest upon seeing the purple beads shining over him. Aina was quick to shut his snout.
Boss, you're back!
Aina forced his mouth shut once more. Her eyes shone upward. Sep curled up in her own corner mere inches away. This is no place to speak. Aina took Adder's hand and led him outside. They sat on the edge of the cliff where Gyoth's house rested. It wasn't a tall enough hill to see the whole city, but the fire shining through the night in the market and the bigger temples were still discernible past the nightly haze. The chilly breeze that blew in the night proved that dawn soon had truly come and gone, and the northern clouds would be pregnant with snow in a matter of weeks.
I ever tell you I can see your place from here, boss? Sometimes, when I feel sad or lonely, I'll look over here, and I think that at least I'll get to see you tomorrow.
Anna poked Adder's stomach with a smirk.
Yeah. I think about the taters, too. Darn, boss. Give me a chance to be honest for once, will you?
Anna recoiled into a reddening little furball.
Of all the lies I tell, I think the biggest one may just be I hate it here, after all. That was just me whining. I mean, look right there. I found a home. I built a new life from the bits that remained after I ran. I thought I'd be okay, but now everything's breaking all over again. And I feel like this gotta be my fault somehow. Like, serves me right, you know? I didn't see it coming. I didn't want to see it anywhere. I messed up twice. I don't deserve a third chance. My name should be the top of the beast list.
Anna shoved her snout right in front of Adder's. Her purple eyes glowed a warmer hue under the orange moonlight.
Yes, boss?
She pulled at the sides of her mouth and smiled wide, showing each and every last one of her sharp teeth.
Yeah, I should have figured a ways back you ain't no doe, huh?
Her cheeks bounced back into place. She pressed her lips together until they formed a single line. Anna looked deep in thought for a moment. She grabbed Adder's right arm and moved it towards her ears. It only resulted in Adder's hand covering her whole face. Anna looked down at the ground, searching for an answer she couldn't find in her head. Then, an idea struck her. Lacking any branch that wouldn't have been chewed to splinters, she grabbed one of her daggers and turned the tip to the soil. Scribbles followed soon after.
What's that? You making a cool beastbuster weapon design that'll help us win? That's your secret, ain't it? You got some sort of magical hammer that makes you super strong?
Anna flexed her arms and puffed up her chest, showing off every last one of the sculpted muscles that lay under her bristle-white fur, as if saying, "These are my hammers."
Yeah. If someone strong as you still got to run from her problems, what hope do the rest of us got?
Anna heard that quip. She didn't do anything about to show it. Her task took priority, always. Anna's technique lay on the slow, methodical arts. Calligraphy, carving, forging. Those schools that encourage finesse in just a handful of movements, repeating the same steps over and over in order to polish the final product. With this, I mean to infer the abstract circular mass of squared-off spikes she had carved into the surface of Dak Na didn't quite look like anything Adder could ever recognize. And yet, its semblance was clear once Anna pointed at herself.
You? Oh, come on, boss. I don't mean to offend your drawing skills, but there ain't no way that's you. You don't look like that. You're a bajillion times prettier. Here, let me give that a try.
Adder stuck his tongue out as he set to draw Anna as painstakingly detailed as possible, given his circumstances. Holding finer tools wasn't an easy task with hands like his, and much less when artist's tool of choice was a dagger, but Adder did his best all the same. In the end, the figure looked remarkably nothing like the Aina he knew.
What the?
Aina had never been particularly expressive, but she looked even less so than usual.
Well, ma'am, it is clear that if my life depended on my drawing skills, I'd already be dead. This don't even come close to doing you justice. But maybe it's just because I was trying too hard to look real. Here, let me try again from memory this time.
As Adder closed his eye and lifted the dagger, he realized something quite odd. Tried as he may to recall her image, he only just now came to the conclusion that he did not, in fact, know what Aina looked like. And now, having his eye closed for so long while his brain struggled to recall this particular memory, well, his mind started to question what it was he had set off to do. He wondered if that time wouldn't be better spent sleeping, actually. It wasn't until he felt a weight climbing onto his lap that his eye finally jolted open.
Boss? What are you...
Unbothered by Adder's many frustrations, Aina kept drawing intently. Her rough circles and lines soon became the shape of a man with one and a half horns, old and angry, with a mighty beard and a cane. That one was easy enough. Then two triangles came to join him, inverted one over the other, with only a line connecting them. It took the waves and the lines of wind to convey the message properly.
Ship?
Anna drew one last thing besides the ship. Tall and long, sharp triangles on its head and on its face. She drew a circle over the three.
Your family.
Anna paused for a moment to observe her creation. She nodded. She began scribbling letters on top of each drawing. Then she looked at Adder expectantly.
I'm sorry, boss. You know I can't read a thing.
She nodded as if to say, I know. She pointed at the letters over the first drawing she made, then took the finger to her chin.
Aina?
Aina nodded eagerly. She tapped several times over to each symbol to remark where each sound had to be pronounced. She pointed at the other creature besides her.
Eka?
Aina nodded again. She tapped at her father's picture with the butt of the dagger and started making noises again. The tendons in Aina's neck started bulging out. She put a hand around the base of her jaw. In a fit of rage, Aina sprang to her feet and slammed the dagger against the ground. Adder knew better than to even think of holding her anymore. She started jumping and swinging her fist, stomping all over the picture.
Whoa, it's okay. Don't force yourself, all right? You've done a lot already.
Anna quieted down after a couple of minutes, but her frustration hadn't gone away. It merely shifted to a different thought. Her efforts didn't feel like enough. not nearly enough. Hoping to make himself useful for once, Adder focused his attention on the strange doodles looking at him from the ground.
You're going back to the ship. With your family.
Anna's ear shot up. She nodded, then she plopped down next to Adder, letting her head rest on his lap.
You don't want to do whatever it is you gotta do, do you? But you've got to.
Anna nodded again against Adder's chest.
That's one way to avoid thinking for yourself, I guess.
Adder and Anna jumped away from each other, except sudden apparition.
Please, don't act so surprised. You could wake a dead man up with a whisper.
I don't speak that loud.
I bet Kaoff would have kicked you out ages ago if he didn't work nights.
Anna turned again to Sep. She pointed two fingers at her eyes, then turned them towards Sep.
You want to watch next time? Oh, dear.
The world had never seen Anna sign a correction faster. She pointed at Sep's eyes and back to herself. Sep heaved a long, indecipherable sigh as she dragged her hooves towards Anna.
You were asking me to read your gaze. Is that it?
Anna nodded resolutely.
Will you insult me again if I do?
Again? Boss.
Anna put a hand to her chest and made a face that screamed, I would never, convincing exactly no one.
No takebacks, then.
Sep crouched down next to Anna, holding her knees to one side.
He must have mentioned he could do this, too.
No. He failed to mention it.
Really?
Oh!
Seeing how he talked about you, I thought he would have run to tell you the second he found out.
Then you were wrong. You must be a terrible judge of character for a mind reader.
Sep shrugged nonchalantly.
I don't like this. How am I supposed to know what this Floss is hearing?
Take your time dropping insults. It's not like we had anything important to do in the morning.
You'll be far less horrid when you find a knife lodged between your ribs at dawn.
See? I can make you be as eloquent as I need to. Just take a deep breath and think of what you'd like to say.
You're exhausting. I don't know how Adder puts up with you. But...
It's the butt.
He does. So, please, take care of him.
I won't make any promises.
Nor did I expect you to. Since we're at it, I'm sorry I can't seem to remember you. I see I was important in your life, somehow. I'm sure I felt you were a huge nuisance, and I could use more reasons to dislike you. Next time, I'll ask Killigrap to share embarrassing stories about you. You'll be the laughingstock of the town before you know it.
Anything else?
Just one thing. Your ass is the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen in my life.
What?
And I need you to tell Adder that I...
That pulled away with closed eyes.
No, you tell him that yourself.
Sep dragged Adder down by the arm.
Come on, dear. Time to do your homework.
Adder kneeled down in front of Anna, craning his head towards her. He opened his eye wide and held his breath in, to the point he was completely immobile. Adder had to take a hand to his face at last, and a tear started peeking out the corner of his eye.
I'm sorry. I'm trying my best, but I can't hear anything.
Then perhaps you should be the one saying something to her.
The suggestion was punctuated with a wink and a soft kick in his tail. A deep breath preceded the declaration that would echo all over the hills of Slander.
I love you! I love you, I love you, I love you! And I'll be back for you no matter where you gotta go! You hear me? I love you this much! And that's from one side of the world to another! You always got my love with you!
Anna's face turned deep red, but not nearly as red as her face went when Adder wrapped his arms around her and leaned in for an unexpected kiss.
Oh.
Anna's life seemed to escape her body. It was then Adder's time to freeze, thinking that he'd done something wrong.
Woo! Bravo! Bravo! Encore!
If looks could kill, Anna would have slipped on a banana peel and stabbed herself. So she did the next best thing she could immediately think of. She licked Adder's face before hurling herself down the glyph where he couldn't reach her, running for her life. Adder turned to look at Sep, speechless.
Why'd you do that?
You two give me anxiety.
Steph shrugged her arms behind her back, smiling with a level of honesty she rarely saved for anyone.
And I owed her one for before.
Well, thanks for the help.
I have a terrible feeling that we're scheduled to run out of that soon.
Achievement unlocked, 3 of Hearts.
Hell yeah.
Adder's eye flew open as his body catapulted itself forward. He couldn't help but pat his chest and his face, making sure everything was where it should be. He was in his house, in his bed.
Don't tell me I slept in. Oh, was I dreaming out loud again just now, Mr. Bard? Bard?
No reply. The sun was rising somewhere beyond the missing wall, like any other morning. Gyoth's bed, his slightly bigger hay-filled burlap sack, to be precise, lay discarded paces away as usual. But the bard himself was oddly absent from his favorite spot in these hours of the morning, Adder's pillowy chest.
I realize that you're trying to bribe me, and I'm fully okay with that.
No, I swear that's what really happened. His chest made such a nice headrest that every single character in the story shoved their face against it, intentionally or not, at least once.
I mean, I can believe that.
Talking from experience, are we?
I thought that ought to balance the accusations of butt favoritism.
The booty stands proudly on its own, unmatched.
Wow. I feel like this needs to be like an inspirational quote that I put up on my wall.
Hold on, taking a snip of that one too.
Naturally.
This has been a good laugh.
There was very little that could force Gyoth out of his bed so untimely. The break of dawn was Adder's time to rise, not his. Adder looked around, wondering what else was missing, trying to piece together the puzzle of his memories after the second most stressful day in his life.
This way, Adder.
Adder blinked at the voice. Before his eye had time to open again, he was already on his feet.
Sip! You're here.
What? Did you think I'd change my mind and run away in your sleep?
No. It's just... it's been a while since I last woke up with you around. I missed that.
Now I feel bad for having considered it then. I never thought I'd hear anyone say they missed the sight of me in the morning. Here, you deserve a reward. Close your eyes.
Adder closes one eye and purses his lips, hoping to find Sip's face very close. Instead, he got a slice of something shoved in his mouth.
What's this? It's good.
I believe it's an orange of some kind. I was hungry, so I went to fetch us some breakfast.
You what?
There you go. Rick, there you go. He's finally eaten.
Took him long enough.
You brought fresh fruit into Slander? That's like hollering from the rooftops that you're living the high life. But where did you even get this?
Do you want to know?
Adder hesitated, but Sep did not. With a mischievous grin, she placed one of the oranges in his hand.
The orange I gave you belongs to me. Return it.
Yes, ma'am.
Adder stretched out the orange towards her. Sep grabbed it solemnly.
Do you want it back?
What want back?
Your orange.
Oh, that's for me? I mean, if you don't want it, I'd sure be happy to get that off your hands. But I still want to hear where you got it.
Of course. I'll tell you later.
Adder ate his orange happily, unaware of the edge beneath Sep's smile.
I think I've fully come around on the matter of your escapade into my mind, Adder. You managed to dredge up some incredible memories.
Sep's becoming a Sephy.
Yeah? What crime?
All sorts. Mostly feelings, in fact. I was convinced that I was fully aware of all my thoughts and abilities. But I guess I wasn't even capable of controlling that much after all.
Speaking of knowing, you got any clue where Gyoth is?
That loser wandered off a while ago saying he'd make us leave whether we wanted to or not. So, I'm fully expecting another argument once he gets back.
There was a knock on the door.
Speak of the bard.
Sep reached out for the handle, but Adder yanked her hand back. Another knock. Adder still held her hand.
Adder, my beloved, are you in there? I seem to have misplaced my keys. Kindly open the door for me.
Just walk around.
We ain't got no keys. I'm gonna say that. Knock.
Okay. Stepanatter waited with bated breath for the next knock.
Hove it up, scoundrel! I know you're in there, you treacherous thief! I have captured that undersized manservant of yours. If you don't want him to suffer the same fate as you, I suggest you give yourself up at once.
Oh, mine adder! I'm so sorry. I had to tell him all about how you kidnap his death and coerce his death, my poor childhood friend, the enormous Chasifo Maseptut, to retaliate against Sir Askanath.
I knew it! I knew it! It was all a plot to ridicule me! But how dare you blackmail me through my bride-to-be! Release her, villain!
Adder looked at Sep, absolutely horrified. She grinned back with an innocent shrug.
I guess that's my cue to leave.
Oh, Sir Askadath! My love! Please help! This handsome villain threatened to hurt my elderly maid if I didn't go along with his plan!
For some reason, Sep couldn't even start to guess. Instead of immediately darting away, Adder started roaming the room in a panic, kicking open every sack and rummaging through every hay pile that had so faithfully served as a bed for his stay.
Ah, don't come in yet, I beg you! He's put a dagger to my throat and will slice it open if you dare step in!
After much running in circles looking for an alternatives, Adder finally settled for Gioff's sleeping bag. He tugged at the sides to make it wider and wider until the seams were about to burst.
I find you time, you moron! What are you doing?
The buck lifted the sackcloth over his head.
Adding realism to the scene!
He didn't so much shove Sep into the burlap sack as stuff her in it head first. With a grunt, he heaved the newly kidnapped royalty onto his shoulder and dashed off through the missing wall. There was no way around the house, and there was no way back. Elbar had brought a whole squadron of guards with him. Adder stopped dead short in front of the cliff below them. He hadn't thought quite this far ahead, and now he faltered to continue. Elbar finally tackled the door open, finding absolutely no resistance to his attack and hurling himself and five other guards to the ground instead. He looked up in time to see Adder climb to the top of a makeshift slide, a tipped over outbox to be precise, and disappear under the cliff.
What are you waiting for? Get them!
Everyone gulped, watching the results of such an action happen in real time. The friction made quick work of the outbox, tearing it down into brick shards far faster than this makeshift slide could hurtle through the steep fall.
Crap, 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 crap!
Can we just take a moment to appreciate the grumpy face on this burlap sack?
That's what I'm saying. It looks like a cat when I first saw it.
The only item that remained between Adder's butt and the rocks by the time he slid down to a halt at the bottom of the slope was his underwear.
Those are my good pants.
How dare you mock me like this, one-eyed scoundrel! I shall flay your buttocks myself for this!
Cliff already beat you to that. Elbar leaped towards the steep cliff with Gioff still in tow. Impressive as it had been, Adder had no intention whatsoever to remain to see the result of his heroics. Adder stopped running at last, finally collapsing to his knees in a shaded alley hidden behind a grill. He set Sep on the ground beside him. He reached for the sack, fully intent on helping Sep slip out of it, only to get headbutted in the nose. Sep jerked from side to side until she managed to tear a hole from her head with the tip of her horns. The rest of her body remained very much stuffed inside the sack.
Anderson! What is wrong with you?
I don't know. I don't know anymore. I thought you wanted me to steal you away.
And you just had to choose the one chance we had at fixing everything?
Don't you wee me after dropping me in it like that. I hate y'all. Y'all are the worst friends I've ever had in my life.
Okay, just to be clear, I had nothing to do with this. Gioff sold us both out. Pretty in line with all his life decisions, really. Abandoning people is basically his whole personality.
What's your excuse then?
I know when to fall by the wayside. Look around you, Adder. None of us actually give a damn about the city or the beasts. You just proved that prick right. We're all just serving our own purposes in the end.
Adder lifted his head up from between his knees.
No, that ain't what happened just now, is it? He wasn't being a self-centered turd for once. He did it for you. He screwed me over because he wanted you safe.
What? Don't start trying to justify this now. Not everything has a reason, okay? He's just an asshole. Does it matter what he did it for? We're screwed either way.
It matters because it means he's good deep down and he wanted to help somehow. And he got you playing along too.
It was a good chance, so that doesn't mean I have to thank him for it. I didn't ask for his help or yours.
Of course you didn't. You would have just ordered us to do something if you'd thought of that first. How are you supposed to ask for help when you just think everyone's below you?
Adder wanted to stop talking, to stop damning himself after having made a fool of himself, but the words kept on coming.
I got it now. I got it for real, I think. I know why it's always black or white with you. You don't ever want to think of the reason behind things, because you're so convinced that you got us figured out. It's Miss Mind Reader's world. And if you were wrong, you'd have to admit we're all free to make our own choices. Well, it's looking like the end of your world as we know it, Your Majesty. How long are you going to keep on dawdling through life, splitting everyone between folks who could do something for you and folks who are beyond redemption?
If you are done with the lecture, I have a life to get back to. Enjoy yours.
Sap never walked with anything less than a dignified stride, not even to saunter away in a burlap sack. Adder found himself alone once more. It occurred to him that maybe he would have preferred to let her keep thinking that, to be as far from right as possible. The closer he got to being honest with himself, the closer he got to driving everyone away from him. Nobody liked the person he was when he wasn't bending over backwards to please them. He didn't sag for long. He wasn't completely alone, after all. Adder turned his face towards the slums, determined. Towards the one person that had stayed with him throughout everything, for better or worse. The man who had consistently been unreliable all along. He wouldn't give up on Geoff.
Wait! What are you doing?
Huh? What are you doing? Weren't you?
Elbar will be coming that way, you cretin! Are you trying to get yourself killed?
Adder pondered the very same thing.
You know why I'm friends with Geoff, Sip? It's because I get him. We got a lot in common, the two of us.
No, you don't! What are you even...
Adder brushed Sep's cheek with his thumb. His smile carried a story.
Remember that one buck I knew? The one from down yonder the steps? Well, he didn't get along with his family either. It wasn't all they hoped he could be, see. They didn't like him very much by the end, so they sent him away hoping he'd come back someone better. But he never did get better. He never did come back. He messed his whole life up. Forever. So we get. He ought to stayed and taken whatever they got in store for him. But he went and ran. The price was everything he'd ever known. I don't know if you've ever met the guy. But the thing is, he can't ever return home. And even if he could, he couldn't look him in the eye again.
You don't know that.
Adder tried to keep the smile on his face.
To be fair, he was kind of an innocent guy. And he had huge dreams, so Geoff scammed every last coin out of him the second he arrived. Don't tell him I told you this, but instead of getting mad at the bard, the guy couldn't help but think, whoa, I wish I was like that. He wanted to be cold, to be fine with the bad things he'd done, but no matter how much he tried, he could be Adder, but he couldn't be the rest of that. He was still me no matter what. And there ain't no way that me guy could survive leaving his family behind twice.
Of course he can! He's just been betrayed! Come on! They'll cut your head and mine if they find us talking like this!
I'm sorry, Sip. Love, I'm for real grateful for all the chances you've given me, but I meant what I said. I ain't choosing between the people I love no more.
Why are you being like this? Can't you listen to me just this once? You're only going to get hurt.
No, I get that. And I think you're way smarter than I am, because you can see this don't make a lick of sense. I'm sure it's one of those honor bugs rich folks get sometimes. Must have caught a bit of it somewhere. I'm sorry I dragged you here. You don't gotta come with, okay? Go find somewhere safe to hide and tell them you escaped when I wasn't looking. Be as selfish as you say you are this one time. I want to stop worrying you too.
This isn't like you, Adder.
I ain't... No, you're right. It ain't. But I sure wish it was. So I'm just gonna pretend a little longer.
Adder glanced away, knowing that he would rather do anything else in the world. He knew that if he looked at Sep just one more time, he would remember all the times she had asked him to run away with her, and he wouldn't dare say no ever again. But then he felt a little tug in his little finger, and he knew that it was already too late to escape. He turned around just to find Sep staring at him with glassy eyes and an undignified blush across her cheeks.
You're not going to leave without a proper goodbye, are you?
How proper are we talking?
You said it yourself. This could be the last time we see each other.
All right, look, I miss you too, and I'm very glad I'm alive and we're alone in the three. No, they know. I'd be right happy to do whatever you wanted, wherever you wanted. But the whole city plus size is coming for us right now, and I gotta go save Gyolf and...
I will not settle for anything less than a kiss. Or are you afraid of getting a little warm now?
Afraid? Of a kiss? Anderson, son of Gear, father of the upper field, don't know no fear, Missy!
Are you done?
Yes, ma'am.
Adder pulled Sep closer with one of his shovel hands and leaned in, his heart pounding faster in a second than the whole last moon. A kiss so heated that it warmed up his very soul, made him feel as grand and special as she'd made him feel time and time again. He forgot for a brief moment that there was a world outside and that both their necks were in grave danger. There was only the kiss as far as he was concerned. This moment too would come to pass, alas.
Good. Now play along.
Something struck Adder's face at full speed, leaving a bright red mark. He needed an instant to register that it was, in fact, Sep's hand.
Unhand me, you brute! How dare you try to steal me away from my love! My lips belong to one man and no more! Oh, Sir Ascadath! Sir Ascadath, where are you?
Hark! I think I hear the melodiously grating voice of Jaceef somewhere, slapping the man who made her slap your brother in the first place! Yeah!
Jaceef! Oh, my love! How could I fail to understand such an obvious ploy?
But what?
Oh, no! I can't believe this deer was actually a pirate, planning to make me his queen! I said play along, you numbskull! Going to take me to the Sea of Fensnar to claim the throne of the Saxarot for himself!
Yeah! Whatever she said! Gonna take her to my lair and get legally married to her! Gosh darn it, Sip! I'm gonna kill you to give me a heads up from time to time!
Guards! Forget that beautiful bastard! We have to stop that fiend before he makes away with my princess!
The guards that were just catching up rushed to grab Yoff. They looked at the stumpy bard, then they turned their faces to Elbar.
What are you standing there for, you layabouts? Never mind. I'll go get them myself.
Gyolf's all like, a beautiful bastard, huh?
There. Now I don't have to worry about you. You're welcome.
You really did turn me into Captain Horneater.
You can spend all the time you need crying about your infamy once we have decided our next move.
What? Oh, no, ma'am. I've changed my mind. I want to drop you. I'm dropping you as soon as I can. We're getting too far away from Slander as it is, and there's no way I'm carrying you all the way to Illagram.
I'm the only woman standing between you and the tip of Elbar's sword.
And your sacrifice is much appreciated, but I can 100% guarantee he wouldn't be coming after me if I wasn't carrying your majesty. If you want to help, just go and magic the guards away or something.
Of course! Let me try and persuade the minds of 12 armed deer while I'm bouncing on your shoulder. Or maybe I could burn the sack and set the whole street on fire as we pass to give them actual reasons to call me a Sephi. Is that what you want me to do, Adder? Arson?
Ma'am, I'd never. I'm sure you've gone and done plenty of arson on Lord Snotty Snout already. We don't need any more of that.
Well, now.
That's a pun right there.
Aw, is that jealousy I see? Did you think he had a pretty mark like yours?
Nah, I don't think nothing. But hey, since you're bringing it up, I'm sure the jerk-ass could use a mark or two. You should leave a big red blotch on that butt hanging from his face. One to match his little bros. That'll teach him how to treat a lady.
Like you knew much better.
So what if I don't do things the knightly way? I'm still a farmer, ma'am. I may not wear the right clothing, but I definitely know a thing or two about platinum. Nope. You know what? I think you made your point. You're still making a mistake all the same.
I'm not the one reaping what he sowed. If you were half the farmer you claim to be, you'd know some harvests are too fast for one husband.
Ma'am, I'd call the whole darn town over if these two farmhands ever stop being enough. But why'd you keep running back to that gosh darn friggin' Silver Spoon Fred Musclehead of all the Horneaters and Doc Nah? When he don't even want you!
Oh,
I didn't realize I needed your approval to choose my patrons.
You didn't even choose him!
Adder, please. You can't choose the love of your life. He for whomst my heart flutters. All I can ever dream of. Yada yada, what a heartthrob.
Yeah, right. You're lying to me and to yourself. It's his horns after all, ain't it? So big and shiny and...
Why, thank you. I polish them every day.
With a quick swoosh, Elbar sent his cape away. He smirked as he tipped his swords toward Adder, clearly set on not letting them walk another step.
How late did you... Your legs have been slowed down by the weight of your villainy, miscreant.
Yeah, that's gotta be it.
Adder got the low end of his back kicked.
I mean, hands off my booty, landlubber! Tell me what you've done with Gyoff or your precious wife is gonna, walk the plank? Am I supposed to say that there? Anyway, she's gonna kick the bucket if you don't tell me where my friend is.
Friend? Friend? Not only are you wicked, one-eyed scoundrel, you are stupid as well. You never even noticed that your herald betrayed you from the start.
No, I 100% knew that. Yar.
So you think? But we were one step ahead of your evil wits yet. He was the one who instructed me to wait for you right here.
Like, here?
In this general area.
Isn't that where it hurts when you get kicked in the nuts?
Don't start interrupting me with your shameless mockery! I know your vocabulary is far faster than that!
Yeah, Captain. Pay attention to his spiel, or he'll have to start reciting it all over from the beginning and he'll end up hurting his throat.
Thank you, babe. Screaming threateningly always takes a toll on me.
You ever try hollering from your belly? I heard it. Sorry.
Where was I? Oh, yes! Gyoff knew that your wretched heart would be crushed by the immense guilt you'd feel over abandoning the only man who had been compassionate enough to offer you a single crumb of affection in your miserable existence.
He's gonna catch a crumb of affection from these hands when I find him.
And trust me, Brigand, if there is one thing I hate more than peasantry, it's piracy! Pay for your things, goddammit! Artists need money to eat!
And writers and actors!
Maxie, wow. You are a gem.
And every other freelancer in the world. Those idiots think passion is its own reward, have empathy and the creative spirit of a boot soul.
Stealing from small creators is not the same as stealing from soulless corporations that feed on the creative output of the workers they employ, okay?
The more you know.
Stealing from people like Elbar is always morally correct, though.
Oh, no, yeah, bleed him dry.
Return my treasure to me at once! Do
Yay,
you know how
eat
much
the
my
rich.
Love has cost me?
I'll return her gladly, but only if you can match the price you paid for her. I'll be gone and y'all be happy together at last.
No, Sir Askadath. Adder, what is wrong with you? Don't give in to his demands.
You miserable liar. If your love could be so easily broken by gold, you never even loved her to begin with.
Didn't you just say you bought her?
Don't you dare lump us together, you thief. I'm a self-made stag who built his wealth honorably through his inheritance.
Just kill me now, please.
How dare you order me to murder you? I will murder you on my own terms.
You know, Elbar, when he first emerged in this game, as a character, I found him kind of annoying. But the longer it goes on, the more amused by him I am.
He's such a, like, high school musical jock antagonist.
He really is. And the freaking dialogue, everything with him is chef's kiss.
Elbar pointed his sword towards Adder. There he remained, frozen in that gesture for a full minute, just to prove his point.
Now would be a real good time to do something, Sip!
It really would, wouldn't it?
Sip!
Die!
Sir Askadath!
The point of Elbar's unnecessarily long blade stopped just a hair's width short of the tip of Adder's snout.
Behind you.
The knight stood stately still. A moment later, he came crashing down chin first against the ground. Blank were his eyes and his expression as he lay on the pavestones. Red was the blood that trickled down his forehead. Extraordinarily red, not blue or purple or any other color Adder had so often heard distinguished nobles from people like him. The pirate and the princess looked up, struggling to keep their jaws locked in a place at the sight that awaited them. Where Elbar lay now stood none other than Miss Rochelle, still heaving on a fireplace poker, now bent in a particularly incriminating way. Rochelle tossed the poker indented with Elbar's head shape next to its rightful artist. Then she reached out over the body to get a purchase on Sep's arm, her face a presage of dread.
Come with me! That won't keep him down long.
Sounded like she hit him really hard.
It's okay. It was just his head. He'll
oh,
be
that's
fine.
True. Steph hesitated at first, but a single grunt from the massive body below them was enough to get both of their hooves moving towards Heartache District, with the brief stop en route to stop on Elbar's head, just in case. Two women sprinted away, leaving two men behind them. Then again, Adder was much too preoccupied to think about chasing them. His eye was transfixed on the brief insinuation of a glowy-eyed silhouette observing him from the other end of the alley. He felt a drop of cold sweat zigzagging down his back. His legs tensed up, but he still couldn't move. His whole body was frozen in fear at the sight.
Did I stutter? Move!
By the time Adder blinked again, the shadow was gone. He shook his head and began running after Mr. Rochelle, making sure to accidentally trip over Elbar's head as well, of course. The older woman led them through the narrow alley skirting the walls of the Heartache District, home of aggregated houses of ill repute and slimy storefronts, where one could get most anything except sunlight. Streets that guards would oh so casually avoid in their patrols, lest they be recognized with their uniforms on. Adder kept turning his head back, nearly losing sight of their guide time and again. He wasn't familiar with the area and would have much preferred not to have to excuse his way through these streets, so he picked up the pace, making a great deal of effort to catch up to Sep. Her stride, he noted, was surprisingly quick when lightened by the horror of having to be carried by Adder in front of anyone else.
Sep! Sep, I think I saw.
Are you trying to take us on a leisure tour around Heartache or what, Raoul?
Rochelle didn't bother replying to that. She merely tossed back a crumpled piece of paper as she ran. A wanted poster, and Adder could count himself lucky that he couldn't read a single thing it said about him. It was clear that around streets like these, discretion remained the lowest common denominator. Sep was clearly winded, but she thankfully wouldn't have to keep appearances up much longer. Their stroll finally drew to a close as the alley opened up into a guarded street once more. The street that led to the Desert Rose, no less.
Why are we here?
What a deep question, dear. Why are any of us here, really?
You know what I mean.
Well, I'm here because you didn't manage to spoil the surprise for Sir Ascadaf. Is that how you thank me for saving your boy knight's life?
And speaking of me, I'm pretty sure I just saw...
What were you expecting? A warm welcome and a toast in your name?
I'm sure there are a lot of ways to greet someone that don't involve trying to get them killed.
Not for you, there aren't.
Oh, honey, come on. Is that really the tone you want to start this conversation on after disappearing for 3 days?
I was just hoping you'd have forgotten by now. Anyway, stop stalling the conversation. How did you know where to find us?
Let's just
also,
leave it at Geoff and I had an axe to grind, shall we?
If you want to know why Sep is like this, it's because she's been with Rochelle for like a decade. Literally every day, every moment is a verbal sparring match with her.
Yeah. She's had
so he was playing both ends?
She knows Geoff too?
Yeah, everybody in this game knows each other.
Yeah, I know, right? Sep made a discreet choking motion towards Adder.
Know him? My, I would certainly hope so. He was the only horn eater my age around the Desert Rose. Huh. The evenings we spent roasting fools to death.
Hold up. You saying you two are the same age?
Are you ready to gamble your life on your next words, dear?
You look younger.
Flatterer.
If you two are done with this stupid farce, I'm still waiting for an answer. Why would you take me back? No, I know that much. Why bring Adder along? Is this really all Geoff's doing?
Is that so surprising? Even a squandered waste of a man like him can't help wanting what's best for his little sister and her boyfriend.
Before Sepp had a chance to contest any of those statements, Miss Rochelle scurried off towards one of the guards.
Oh, help, please. Sir Askadoff needs reinforcements. Some miserable ruffian has knocked him unconscious in the middle of Forlorn Avenue.
The squad standing in way immediately marched away. Rochelle merely watched them leave. After this, she waltzed around the corner and headed for the servant's back door.
See you on the other side.
The door was left ajar, only adding to Sepp's confusion.
We're not actually going in, are we? It's clearly a trap.
Sepp, I've been trying to tell you. I think I saw a beast tailing us.
You think?
I know a whole darn lot of fluffy folk with glowing eyes and interesting body shapes. Could be a number of things.
That was
a
fair enough.
Yeah, that's
a
mood.
that's
something I can relate to.
That was a fair enough point, much to Sepp's chagrin. She sighed into her hands, considering their options.
If I have to choose between beasts, I suppose I'd rather deal with the one I know best.
Don't worry, Sepp. I'll be right there with you.
That's the part that worries me.
The back door into the desert rose closed loudly behind them. Though they truly feared the worst, Raoul didn't suddenly leap towards them with an army of guards in robes. She didn't seem to pay any heed to them at all, busy as she was washing her hands in the ceramic basin by the entrance. When she finally turned around, the apprehension that the lovers radiated made her grin.
I have to admit, I didn't think you had the mettle to come in.
We're in trouble, Raoul. Far worse trouble than you or Elbar.
Oh, trust me, I know. It's written all over your face. I hadn't seen you this scared since that time you ran into the door and snapped your little horns in two. Oh, you cried like the world was crumbling around you. Nothing we can't fix this time either, I'm sure. Feel free to slip out of that fancy new dress of yours into something more comfortable. I'll ask the servants to bring some tea.
I'm not leaving Adder alone with you.
Then I guess you'll get to wear matching clothes for a little longer. How fun.
Miss Rochelle swaggered off to the kitchen to request a few things. After that, she ushered her guests to the exquisitely decorated meeting room nearby, where anything from raises to the deepest secrets in the palace were always discussed. Raoul reached out for a clipboard lying on the rock glass table and started taking notes. Honestly, she couldn't have looked more unbothered by their presence as she went about scribbling down notes if she tried. It occurred to Adder, one of the rare strokes of genius he had every once in a while, that such stillness of face and mind had to be the product of years of effort, all manners of defense built up in answer to certainty that her secrets could be stolen at a glance. This observant thought vanished into the nether as one of the servants arrived with a kettle, a small tower of pastries, and only two glasses. Adder had spent moons having licentious dreams about this re-encounter with the love of his life, the almond pastry slathered in fig jam, honey, and topped with a date that he had so unwillingly abandoned. He was well past the point of taking any hints.
What's the big idea, Raoul?
Well, if you must know, I'm trying to figure out our bleak night schedule. I'm thinking about shifting some of the performances around on the 2nd/4th next moon. See? I have a feeling one of the usuals is going to be grounded for a long, long time.
Well, if I may...
You may not.
Just keep stuffing your face at her. It's fine. Sepp and Rochelle locked eyes, surprised at their simultaneous intervention. Adder limited himself to shrinking back into a seat, certain that he didn't want to arouse the anger of either woman.
Raoul, I need you to listen to me like you haven't ever listened. It's the only thing I'm going to ask you in my whole life.
Ooh, a favor and a lie right after getting saved from a romantic escapade. This should be good.
Rochelle pulled the kettle towards her and started pouring herself some tea. Sepp took this as her cue to start.
I know that what I'm about to say may seem impossible to believe, but Heirloom will be attacked soon. By beasts, no less. They're not just a fantasy, Raoul. We've seen them ourselves. If what they said is true, they're planning to carry out some sort of moral population call on the deer. I don't know how long we have or who's going to be affected by it, but they'll wreak havoc on the city if we don't do anything to stop them.
Miss Rochelle remained very still for a moment. The only sight of life in her was the subtle quiver of the hand holding the kettle, which had toppled the ornate drinking glass quite a while ago.
Dang my melt, sugar. That's horrifying.
Do you believe me then?
Of course I do. I know you wouldn't lie about something this silly. If you say beasts are coming to eat us all, then they most definitely are.
Oh, bless the gods. You have to help us then. You're the only person left in the city with enough power to stop them.
I'm honored you think so highly of me. But I don't have the power to do anything about this. I couldn't even stop you from frolicking around with this mismatched fawn and ruining your future with Sir Ascadaf.
None of that matters now. Besides, I'm sure that Elbar is jumping in joy at the chance of rescuing a swooning princess from a pirate or whatever. We'll be fine.
Honey, please. You aren't so naive as to think that little stunt of yours will be enough to mend your relationship with a knight, are you? You're dead to him now. You made sure to thoroughly soil both of your reputations in front of the whole city yesterday.
That's not what happened at the trial.
So that's what it was. See, a doe like me tends to ponder why there's a whole puncheon of wine instead of a gazelle at her doorstep. One thing leads to another, and then, what do you know? I got to see my favorite girl slapping Lord Burbith of Ascadaf. It's funny how news flies when you're barely yards away from them.
Miss Rochelle took a long sip from her glass. Her eyes peered over the edge, gauging Sep's reaction. A wry smile accentuated her point as she continued.
We're so fortunate that our princess never needed to learn from her mistakes.
How odd. Adder couldn't help but feel like he had heard such an accusation before. Little did that matter now. Sep was staring intently at Rochelle with eyes wide open, glowing.
Who told you?
Just Sif! There you go, doing funny voices again. Don't waste your tricks on me, dear. I was going to tell you anyway.
The flame behind Sep's eyes disappeared, but she didn't relax her stance one bit.
I knew we'd have to have this talk sooner or later. Kids grow up so fast. I guess... no. Yes? Perhaps you are finally old enough to hear the truth about your mother.
Say what? You really think someone as smart as Sep's gonna fall for such an obvious...
Sep snapped Adder's snout shut.
Oh, my poor Thar. With a guy always spending his nights down the street and three children to mind, your mother needed a confidant. Someone who could fill her loneliness when that dead weight wasn't around reminding her of the vows they'd made.
What are you getting at, Rell?
Come on, dear. You know what I'm saying. Won't you read my mind? Would you rather I spell it out for you?
Rochelle placed the empty tea glass back on the table.
Thar was my wife, as far as either of us was concerned. Not his.
Knew
you
it.
And Mom? When? Why? What?
I like that last. What?
Adder needn't have been a gaze reader to guess that Sep was mentally going over every time she'd seen her mother and Rochelle slipping away together in the past.
Are you sure that you want me to fill you in on all the details?
Sep gripped the edges of her skirt, her face burning with more emotions than she had words for.
Didn't you used to say you were Gigolf's age?
Don't you ever dare ask me that again, dear. All that matters in the end is that her two sons looked and sounded too much like him. It was hard for her to even talk to them, to make excuses for a guy day after day, to have a constant reminder of all the poor decisions locking her in the pillory of his life. But it was different with you. You were her own reckless choice. Her daughter to the very end. Her precious little curse.
Rochelle leaned back into her seat, drinking in Sep's stupefied reaction.
Yes, she told me everything about your circumstances from the beginning, darling. That's how I know those half-made tattoos on your boy knight aren't precisely a fashion statement.
So that means...
It means that come next week, Elbar will have forgotten all about you and you can simply start your tale anew as many times as you need. How exciting!
Hold on one second. Hold on, because I can't believe what I'm hearing. You knew about the curse, and yet you kept her locked away from me and everyone else in the world all this time?
Of course not. She chose to shut herself in, just like she chose to let herself out. And I'd say she's learned to open up quite a lot since then.
And you just casually let her do anything she wanted as long as it lined up with what you wanted her to do. You think you're fooling anyone here? You heartless tunk.
Well, that's uncalled for. I let Yasif leave and she came back of her own accord. After you broke her heart, may I add. You do remember that, correct? I only had to welcome her back and watch her cry over some worthless, misshapen fawn like I knew she would. I didn't even have to ask. It was obvious like that.
Adder opened his mouth to retort, but the right excuses failed to take shape.
Don't think I don't sympathize, dear. Offering your unconditional love to someone like her takes a thick hide. Much thicker than someone like you could ever have. I will give credit where credit is due, however. You've really gone above and beyond to come back and break her heart one last time.
I'm never going to hurt her again.
No, you're not.
These words were sinister enough to throw Adder back out of his rage. They were emphasized by the familiar sound of a mechanical whir approaching somewhere behind the wall.
You really should have run away when you had the chance.
Step only snapped out of her own shock when the door swung open, revealing a finely dressed merchant followed by a retinue of marble deer. Four of them, to be precise.
Tasakir Mat Septut. I apologize for failing to visit sooner.
Taylor! Gyoff sold me how to...
Oh, no, honey. Gyoff isn't that heartless. For what it's worth, he had no clue that we had a guest.
Indeed. I'm afraid I had to keep my presence unannounced. This may very well be the first time I've fallen ill in 10 years, as far as anyone in the guild is concerned. I've been anxiously anticipating my sister's return since the news of the trial reached my ears yesterday. I see I wasn't wrong to worry.
Taylor, whatever it is you've heard, I can assure you that there are more urgent issues to take care of right now.
I'm afraid I have postponed this matter long enough. Rest assured that everything I do for your own safety.
With a snap of his fingers, a golem crept behind Sep and apprehended her, gripping her arms back and away from each other.
Golem, hold her gently but firmly. She's branded a second deer. We don't know what else she may be capable of.
You don't have to do this, Taylid! Ral, please! I'm serious about the beasts! There's no time for this now! We can't possibly fight them! We should evacuate the palace and run as far as we can!
Run, she says! Dear, this is why you'll never be a businesswoman. You let your feelings get the best of you every time.
You aren't thinking about this rationally!
On the contrary, I'd like to think that I'm being quite pragmatic. Anyone with a purse is more than welcome in the city. And seeing how convinced you are of this, Taylor and I are going to find out how much coin the beasts carry very, very soon.
We're all going to...
With a single nod of Taylor's head, the golem shoved his sleeve against her mouth.
Come on, honey. Don't look at me like that. I'm sure you knew this was a trap. Whatever you were hoping to achieve, you miscalculated the risk.
Ral smiled almost proudly.
Ah, the flame of youth. Who knows? Maybe the beast will eat us both and you'll get another chance to pry this place off my dead cold hands. For now, however, I think you need to spend a good long while in your room thinking about what you've done.
Adder! Adder, run! Don't even try to...
Step's muffled screams vanished in the distance as a golem carried her upstairs. Kayla didn't bother turning to face towards Rochelle before speaking.
Keep Septut safe and out of the way. Make sure she doesn't hurt herself trying to escape. And for the love of everything, Ral, get her some decent clothes.
Rochelle pressed her lips into something that could only barely pass as a smile as she closed the door. And yet, right before it was fully shut, she peeked in one last time.
Do me a favor, dear. I know it doesn't make much of a difference at this point, but that twerp truly made sure to treasure Yasif as much as he could. Don't drag this out too much.
Taylor nodded curtly as the door was locked behind him. The moneylender finally had the decency to look someone in the face, just in time to observe Adder circling a table defensively.
Before I remove the last hint of asymmetry from that crooked face of yours, there is something I would truly like to know. What name shall I write on your epitaph?
Addison, son of Garfada the Upper Field! If you gotta write something pretty.
How unsuitable. I would have much preferred a real name. Be it as it may, I must extend my gratitude to you nonetheless, Adder. You have far exceeded my expectations.
Oh, yeah? You don't say.
I had long wanted to emasculate that miserable excuse for a captain of the guard in public. Alas, no matter how long my reach is, noble blood always remains one step beyond. Untouchable for those of us who have everything in common except their veins. I am thankful to you for stealing my sister away from that useless waste of nepotic breath. I truly am.
But not thankful enough to forgive my life, are you?
No. I will simply finish what that oaf started.
Just a half nod. Two of the golems switched into an alert stance. The third got closer to Talid. They lowered their bodies painfully slowly, causing their knee joints to emit a high-pitched hiss that made Adder flinch. Next he knew, they were dashing at an impossible speed towards him. Thinking fast but not straight, Adder grabbed the kettle and hurled it towards the closest golem. The brass projectile bounced away miserably, and the scalding liquid did nothing to deter the machine. Adder kicked the table up just in time to watch a fist go clean through the glass. Undeterred, he gripped the metal frame harder and swung it towards the second golem, hoping to catch both of their hands in one swoop. He found himself lifted off the ground instead, paddling in the air for his life. Moving with unnatural coordination, the golem spun their whole arms in a wide arc that sent both Adder and the table flying against the wall. He heaved as the metal frame and the heavy rock crystal table slammed against his body, though thankfully it didn't shatter. In a battle of strength, he was clearly heavily outmatched. The golems hurtled towards him once more, but Adder had something they didn't have. A ridiculously nimble body. Adder flicked the frame as one of the golems lifted the table, distracting them with the tinkling sound just long enough to roll under their legs and leap towards the door. He dug on the handle with all of his strength, only to remember that it was locked.
Are you looking for the key?
Adder turned his face towards Talid. A white blur struck right where his snout had been just a moment earlier. He saw the arm pass by his face in slow motion, dodged by fractions of an inch, only to land instead inside the mahogany door. The golem rattled its arm, trying to dislodge it from the wood. It finally resolved to swivel its torso around like a spinning top, ripping out a sizable chunk of wood that stuck to him like a shield.
Careful, Adder. That could have been your skull just now.
The hole it left behind was bedecked with splinters, with a few bristles of yellow fur, and half of the bolted lock. A wild idea started to take form inside Adder's mind.
No way! My skull's way thicker than anything these guys could ever break!
We'll have to see about that.
Adder ducked a surprise right hook from the second golem, only to find himself suddenly splayed against the wall by a shield charge from the first one. His face was left completely exposed to a potentially lethal jab, leaving him with less than a precious second to tilt his neck 60 impressive degrees to the right, leaving the golem trapped against the wall. Down from the ground, emboldened by his strategy, Adder spun jump up to send a powerful left upper hook toward the golem's mask. His fist stopped flat against the marble, a narrow crack sprouted up across the artificial face. Adder was rewarded with a broken knuckle for his efforts. The poor boy screamed as he gripped his left hand, cursing and stamping his foot down while the golem futilely tried to remove his hand from the hole it punched in the brick and concrete wall. The shielded golem crept up on him from his blindside, punching him right in the pit of the stomach. Adder's body sank down against the wall. Two more terrifying blows succeeded this first one. And just like that, they stopped, giving him just enough space to fruitlessly attempt to limp away. This ain't nothing, Adder lied to himself as he spat some blood over the carpet. The golem that just landed a hit was approaching him. Another remained next to Talid. The last one continued to struggle to release his arm from the wall. Adder hadn't taken 10 steps when one of the golems grabbed him by the back of the neck, showcasing its quarry for Talid to admire.
Sate my curiosity, Adder. How did you plan for this to end?
Though the boy wasn't particularly predisposed to reply, as focused as he was on keeping down the pastries he'd just eaten, the answer most definitely didn't include a fractured rib or two. He tried to throw a rather miserable punch in the moneylender's direction, only for it to get dodged with supreme ease.
You surely didn't think someone like you could emerge victorious. You didn't presume you could merely elope with my sister and get yourself named a knight for your efforts?
Something tinkled inside Adder's sash as he swayed at the golem's mercy.
You are a shrub, a mere beggar. You will never be good enough for Sep, or Aina, or that pathetic leech Geoff.
Had to reach for his purse.
So how dare you fancy yourself too good for me?
Definitely Geoff's brother. Hatter extended a weary, open fist full of tinkling metal towards Taylor.
I'm so sorry, Mr. Taylor. Would you accept this as payment for all the trouble I caused?
Taylor crossed his eyes down just in time to see two metal rivets sticking out of Adder's fist get shoved right into his nostrils.
Ah!
Ooh.
Whoa.
The golems jittered as Taylor screamed and cursed, clutching his snout. With a well-placed kick to the golem's torso, Adder propelled himself out and away from the automaton's grasp. Still wielding a rivet in each hand, Adder ran back towards a wrecked door and started punching away at the wood, trying to carve a hole that would let him reach the latch.
Adder sinned!
The golem started stirring behind him. The force pulled right out of memories of muscles he no longer had, Adder threw his good arm back and tore the door from its hinges. He spun in place and bashed it against the first of the pursuing golems, splintering all over its head and slammed it to the ground. Adder lurched out of the room, holding his side in one place the best he could, while the second golem futilely tried to leave the room with a chunk of wood still stuck to its hand.
I really don't know why you insist on having him send all that wine. It's not even good. There are much better drinks out there if you just want to batter your liver.
Far removed from all the commotion, Miss Rochelle ambled through the corridors of the first floor, a few steps ahead of the golem that held Sep prisoner.
You don't even care, do you? You just want it because you can get your hands on it. Whether you like it or not is besides the point.
Sep had stopped struggling a while ago. She merely sagged in the golem's arms, her sight firmly set away from Rochelle. This was, somehow, a greater offense to the older woman.
What is it? What are you thinking in that magic brain box of yours? You think that I'm part of this? You think that I wanted any of this to happen? That I somehow plotted the death of that poor hick? I gave you the choice to go through with your stupid elopement and let me forget all about you. But no, you came back with your tail between your legs to drag us all down with you, as you always do. And of course, it's now up to me to fix everything as usual. To say, yes, Mr. Taylor, no, Mr. Taylor, so he won't lift a finger against us for letting things get this far. Like we had a say in all your whims. I used to think you'd thank me when you were older. But the years keep coming and you never seem old enough. I really thought I raised you smarter than this, Sep.
Their stroll finally came to an end once they reached Sep's door. Slowly, methodically even, Rochelle counted each and every key in her keyring, pretending she didn't know the shape of the lock by heart.
It's not fair if you can't even defend yourself, is it?
The golem bore its empty gaze into Rochelle as she tugged its sleeve away from Sep's mouth.
Raise me? Raise me? How warped can you get inside your own lies? You want a medal for doing the bare minimum to drag my weight through the mud just because you loved my mother? This is all your fault, can't you see? Ah, so it's my fault for trying to keep you alive. That's nice.
With a light pat on its back, the golem started marching again into Sep's room. Rochelle pulled her key up again.
All you've ever wanted was to bleed me dry. You never trusted me with my own decisions. You never even cared once about what I needed. I want to see you well, and I want to see you flourish, and I want to keep you from throwing your life away at every turn. You're the one who keeps forcing me to be the villain in your story. What part of that is so hard to understand? How do you manage to make everything about you? If you really care, stop playing the victim for 1 minute and just listen to me, okay? You never had to do any of it. I didn't ask you to. So you've tried to keep me well? Well, you failed. I'm a mess. You're the whole reason I keep trying to throw my life away. Because guess what? I never wanted any of this! Neither did I!
It's 12:07. Maybe we should stop.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Wow.
It is taking longer than expected.
Gross. I mean,
yeah, yeah. Oh, mercy.
Yeah.
Things are getting heated in the Hayseed Night fandom.
I mean, we already had the first half of the stream was so heated.
Mm-hmm.
So much shipping bait.
Is it bait if it's literally just right there? Like, if they're actually just kissing on scene,
I mean, yeah, that's,
on screen, is that even bait?
That's still bait. That's like extra deluxe bait.
It's like mashed. No, wait.
And also, everyone remember they were totally wearing towels
the
whole time.
Yeah.
Don't even think that they weren't wearing towels the entire time.
It was bold, just so you know.
Just stuck to them like glue. Yeah. Not once shifting. Okay. Thanks, everybody, for stopping by. I think we will finish this next time, since Maxie said it was about 6 hours.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. Looks like it, too.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Everybody have a good night. I'm going to go pass out.
Okay.
Yes.
Good night.
Bye,
good night, everyone. Bye-bye.